what you see from the top of the poles. Now it's Xavier riding high. Can the Bearcats pull the upset, or will the Muskies make it two shootouts in a row? Channel 9 Sports presents the Crosstown Countdown live from the Cincinnati Gardens. We are just 1 hour away from the biggest game of the year. Hello again, everyone. I'm Dennis Jansen coming to you live from the Cincinnati Gardens, joined by Ralph Lee and Pat Cummings as we count it down to the Skyline Chili Crosstown Shootout from high above the floor here at the Cincinnati Gardens, Ralph.
That's right, Denny. We got here real early so that you, the fans, could have the best seat in the house.
You know, normally during this time period, we would be enjoying ABC's Wide World of Sports, but to distill their philosophy, Pat, we're about to see the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat out here.
That's right, Denny. This really is a big deal. The coaches may downplay this game, but this game means a lot to the players and the city of Cincinnati. This is going to be fun.
And speaking of fun, during the next hour, we are going to regale you with tales of exploits, great and small, from both these teams. For instance, do you like synchronized swimming? We'll be taking a look at the Musketeers' new training techniques. Danny Fortson has moved from the UC Bearcats to the Denver Nuggets. We'll see how he's doing in the NBA. And check out the rest of the Tri-State alum in the pros. And where were you when Xavier won the NIT? We'll catch up with the man who authored a championship season. Once again, joining me for Channel 9's coverage of the Crosstown Shootout is former Xavier standout Ralph Lee and former UC All-American Pat Cummings. Ralph, I have to ask you this. Year in, year out, we talk about how this game continues to get bigger, yet it does. How do you explain it?
I think it gets bigger and bigger, Dan, because of the fact that each team comes every year ranked. Somebody comes in this game ranked. As in the past, it's been a great game for the city. Now it's got some national implications, and that makes it get better and better. And the fan support is just getting greater and greater.
And I tell you what, Pat, it seems to me that this team, the Xavier Musketeers, what turned it around for them? It seems a lot of people are crediting last year's win over UC.
That's exactly right. It's the second big test for both teams this year. UC, Coach Huggins, seeing who's going to step up for him against the Musketeers, and also Coach Prosser, I mean, with the Bearcats, and Coach Prosser with the Musketeers coming off a loss at Miami earlier this week.
Something's got to give here this afternoon. And speaking of this big game, it's a big ticket as well, a tough ticket. Take a look at these Xavier fans, for instance. No, they are not bringing pillows to class. The Musketeer faithful waited overnight earlier this week, hoping for the precious chance to buy those precious extra student tickets that became available. Xavier fans are hoping for the Muskies' first back-to-back shootout wins in a decade. Speaking of the fans, down among the fans is our new end zone reporter. Dave Lapham is joining us for our Xavier telecast this year. Dave, what's going on down there?
Thanks a lot, DJ. Yeah, down here on courtside, everybody's getting ready for this basketball game. You see the players warming up, see the cheerleaders warming up. The fans are trying to find their seats, get situated, and get ready for this basketball game. The buildup started yesterday at the Crosstown Luncheon. You know, there's a lot of pressure tonight on these basketball teams as they battle for bragging rights of the city. But yesterday there was room for laughter as the Tri-State celebrated a hometown rivalry. The annual Crosstown Shootout Luncheon was held at the Convention Center with both coaches. With both coaches getting it ready with the fans, it's at least one guaranteed highlight every year. But if you hear any chuckling,
do you feel that the early season road loss to Miami will help prepare your guys for the long stretch?
I have no idea.
For Bob, what has changed in Bobby Brandon from last year to this year? He's been able to stay out of foul trouble.
Superior coaching.
Well, DJ, as you can see, both coaches during the course of that event yesterday, very, very thoughtful answers. They're getting ready for this basketball game. It's a serious deal. There's no doubt about it.
Thank you very much, Dave. I'm sure every Musketeer and every Bearcat fan is wearing his or her lucky hat or shirt this afternoon and this evening just to make sure that they don't jinx their team's chances for a win. It might surprise you, however, to learn the lengths to which the Musketeers have gone to make sure that they are ready for their run to the Final Four. It seems that they are taking the conference name Atlantic 10 literally.
This is where you're used to seeing the Xavier Musketeers. Here. Here. And here. But here? I don't think so. This is the first year where the Muskies used the swimming pool as part of their preseason conditioning. For some of the players, it was a worthwhile workout, but for others, it's somewhat more of a floating exercise.
It's real fun to see who can swim and who can't.
We actually have three non-swimmers in the program. We just put the life belts on them and jump in the water and get right after it.
This is the second year David Armstrong is strengthening and conditioning the Musketeers. And whether or not the players take the swimming aspect of the program seriously, the coach sure does.
The use of the water is an effective way to unload the low back and an effective way to unload the shoulders.
The players do a number of exercises while they're in the pool. Everything from running, jumping, and dips can be expected during Coach Armstrong's workout. But for a non-swimmer like Gary Lumpkin, floating is encouraged first.
They try to tell me you have to learn how to float, which I have a problem doing because they say, you know, fat floats and, you know, muscle sinks. But I think for the most part, I end up sinking.
For all the fun and games the players have in the water, most of them are truly getting a good workout. So much of one, they couldn't believe the results.
Most people think that the pool workout ain't hard, but when you get out, you're really tired.
I never realized that water had that much, you know, resistance in it, you know, while you're trying to, you know, condition everything. But, yeah, that's helped tremendously.
Now they're amazed that they can perspire in the water. That's what they tell me.
Now, really, does TJ look like he's perspiring? Even if he's not, though, the rest of the team was working up a sweat and having a good time while they were doing it. But don't ever expect this from them. Their sport is on the court.
Personally, I swim about like a 16-inch concrete block. Pat, any odd training techniques that you were involved in over your college career or your NBA career?
Well, I came to UC to play basketball, but the first thing I know, I'm out on the track running half miles and miles, and I thought to myself, I can't do this. I'm always the last guy.
Did it
or the
help
smartest
you?
Guy.
Thank you very much. Ralph?
I tell you what, Miss Stack came in and did that aerobics thing, and it was the first time I said, we don't do aerobics in my neighborhood. And I remember Coach Stack saying, you don't do aerobics in your neighborhood? I said, no, I've never heard of aerobics.
Well, from aqua training and aerobic training to more basic training, a team that left Cincinnati with one change of clothes and came back with one of the most prestigious titles in the country. Coming up on the Crosstown Countdown, we'll catch up with the Xavier team that captured the NIT title 40 years ago. And how well do you know the Muskies and Bearcats? We'll have a little trivia test for you. In fact, someone's going to win tickets to the big game. We're back live at the Gardens with our Crosstown Countdown. And one thing we know for sure about this game, there are very few casual fans. No one is ambivalent about this game. You're either with Xavier or you're for the UC Bearcats. But we have to ask which group knows the most about their respective teams. Well, lately, Channel 9, of course, has made an investment in the trivia business. Know-It-Alls airs every Saturday night at 11:35 on Channel 9. Right now, host Michael Flannery, the host of Know-It-Alls, is standing by live at the Blue Moon Saloon in Hyde Park. Michael, I take it that you're ready to put some fans to the test.
That's right, Danny. I am here with Linda Hughes, an XU grad of class of 96 from Oakley, and Jeff Bamer, UC grad 97 from Western Hills. And the three of us are here to play the Crosstown Shootout version of Know-It-Alls for two tickets to tonight's game. Now, the two of you don't have tickets, do you?
No.
No? Are you ready to go?
Absolutely.
All right, here's your first question. Ring the bell when you know the answer. What is Skip Prosser's real first name? Is it A, George, B, Ringo, or C, Paul? Linda?
George.
That is correct. All right. You were thinking it was Ringo, weren't you?
I did.
All right, here's question number two. What was Oscar Robertson's jersey number? See, that's not a jersey number at all. That's a foul.
You have to give me options.
Okay, I'll give you options. Was it A-12, B-14, or C-32?
12.
That is correct. We have a tie right now. This is the one for all the tickets. How many Crosstown Shootouts have gone into overtime? A-2, B-3, or C-4?
Three.
Three overtimes. Sorry, that's incorrect. What do you think it is, two or four?
Two.
Two? I should know this by now. No, that is incorrect. So sorry. But who has won the most so far? Who's got the most questions? It's a tie?
It's a tie.
It's a tie? Neither one of you got it? They're both going to have to get tickets. That's how we play. We're giving it away. Denny?
Thanks, Michael. The question that you failed to ask, however, was what year did Xavier win the NIT? John Popovich knows, and he and Gary Massa are getting ready for our game coverage. They join us now for courtside. Gentlemen?
The answer, 1958, into that 1957-58 season, and we'll have more on that in just a second. But first, 3 hours from now, somebody walks out of here with a great big trophy and, of course, bragging rights for another year, Gary.
It's a big deal, John. A Crosstown trophy, that's what they come for tonight. But things have changed in this game. The intensity's changed in this game, and so have the goals of most Division I teams, including the Bearcats and the Musketeers. The goal now is to get to the NCAA tournament.
Of course, not too long ago, the goal was to get to the National Invitation Tournament, the NIT, and that was the place to be in the postseason. This year marks the 40th anniversary when the Xavier Musketeers won the NIT. We caught up with some of the members of that team for a look at that championship season. High expectations awaited the Xavier Musketeers in 1957. They appeared in the NIT the two previous seasons, and fans wanted a three-peat. For head coach Jim McCafferty, it was his first year at Xavier, and a long way from his humble beginnings.
I started on dirt courts outdoors and no net. Now, how do you make a shot without a net, huh? And a nun standing on the sidelines with a chalkboard keeping the score.
His Muskies got off to a winning start, 10-1 early on, and a number 9 ranking in the country. But the loss of one player to academic ineligibility sparked a downward spiral. Starting guard Hank Stein and center Frank Tartarin remember the rocky road leading up to the tournament.
Well, when you think about it, the season was a total disaster. We finished 15-11. Our season didn't come around until we won the NIT.
Just yelled. You know, we had been playing under adverse situations, and we just worked together.
The NIT selection committee saw the trouble Xavier was having and even tried to withdraw their invitation to the tournament. Xavier refused to stay home. Still heading for the first round at Madison Square Garden in New York City, Stein admits he doubted his team's chances.
As a matter of fact, I only took two shirts with me, and I needed a haircut. So we ended up being there, what, about a week, I guess? So that proves how things can turn around and change.
After beating Niagara, Bradley, and St. Bonaventure, the Muskies faced Dayton in the championship.
I think I took a shot with like 6 seconds to go and missed, and then Dayton got the ball back for the last shot. And I think it was Jack McCarthy that put up a short hook shot that looked like it was going in, but it didn't. And so that made me feel a lot better.
In the overtime, Xavier made their free throws. They grabbed a 78-74 victory and the first ever national championship title for an Ohio team. It was a rewarding feeling for everyone involved.
Just the deep satisfaction that we got when we won it. After all that adversity, isn't that right? All that adversity and that deep satisfaction we won it.
There's just no feeling like it. And it stays with you forever.
Father Paul O'Connor was president then, and he said it was the greatest thing that ever happened to the university.
Hank Stein won the MVP award and has a lifetime of memories.
Just being able to look back and say that you were on a team that won a national championship. Not many players can say that.
Very great feeling.
Gary, that was 40 years ago, a very high point, but things didn't kind of all of a sudden snowball from there.
No, they really didn't. Through the 60s and most of the 70s, the Musketeers really didn't have that great of teams, but they brought some great people in, and Bob Stack, we got the Muskie helping us out a little bit here. Bob Stack came in, they hired the right guy there, and then Pete Gillen followed him, and of course Skip Prosser, and really in the last 12 years they've participated in the NCAA tournament 10 times, and you can't argue with that success.
Always nice visiting with those guys. Back up to you, DJ.
Thank you very much, John and Gary. We have an update for Xavier fans concerning the Musketeers' new arena. The school has now set February 26th as the groundbreaking date for the new Convocation Center. As you know, Xavier is planning a $44 million state-of-the-art arena. There it is. It will include an arena that will seat 10,000 and include 22 Founders Suites. The Convocation Center will also include a student dining facility and a conference center to be used by university groups and community organizations. The Convocation Center will be built along the south end of campus, where you see those tennis courts right about there. Although the official groundbreaking will be February 26th, work is already underway. Last month, workers began clearing electrical towers from the site. There is bad news, however. The school is pushing back the opening date for the Convocation Center. So instead of the fall of 1999, the center will be open in the spring of 2000. We are assured it will be worth the wait. One good person to ask about home field advantage is Danny Fortune. The former Bearcat is now with the Denver Nuggets of the NBA, who are currently 0-11 on the road. We'll catch up with him next. And we'll look at the other Tri-State alums in the pros. Even though you don't need us to do that, we'll show you how to do it on your own. So do yourself a favor, grab the mouse instead of the remote, and we'll be right back.
Three, you know the rest.
Welcome back to the Cincinnati Gardens. Dennis Jansen joined by Ralph Lee and Pat Cummings as we count it down to the Skyline Chili Crosstown Shootout. At the top of the show, we talked about preempting ABC's Wide World of Sports and how the world should be focusing on this game tonight. Well, guess what? The world already is, seemingly. As sports director John Popovich joins us, we note that UC and Xavier have attracted enough attention to have eight alums currently playing in the National Basketball Association. John?
That's right, DJ. Xavier and UC both very well represented in the NBA these days. And the newest entry into the show is Danny Fortson, who during his junior year at UC was facing double and triple teams. Finally, he left early to go solo into the NBA. We went up to Cleveland this week just to see how he's faring on the next level.
A year ago, he was the big man for the UC Bearcats. Seldom did the ball come down the court when it didn't get into the hands of Danny Fortson. This year, when the Denver Nuggets come down the floor to start a game, Fortson isn't even in there. In the NBA, Danny Fortson is learning a new role coming off the bench.
I did come off the bench, I remember, as a freshman in Cincinnati for a little bit. And coming off there now, that's what I feel like, you know, just a freshman trying to learn the game.
The environment and assignments have changed, but the challenge of making it big has not for Fortson. Wednesday night, he made his first trip back to Ohio since leaving the University of Cincinnati. His Nuggets were in Cleveland to take on the Red Hot Cavaliers, another stop in his journey around the NBA.
Some nights out there, there's some really great players out there some nights. So some nights, it's really not that, you know, players on your level.
This night, Fortson was winning some of the battles and losing some others. That's all part of being a freshman again. If Danny Fortson hadn't decided to turn pro, he'd be playing in today's Crosstown Shootout. As it is, he played in three of them, and all were memorable for different reasons. When the Bearcats beat the Muskies in his freshman season, it was his introduction to this fiery rivalry. A year later, he had a career-high 40 points and 17 rebounds in a victory over the Musketeers. That was his greatest memory.
I know you're going to ask me what's my worst memory. That's got to be last year.
Even a year later, losing that lead and losing that game of the buzzer has a bitter taste. Those college days now seem like they were so long ago, though everything he learned back in school is still applied out here.
I tell you, if I didn't come to UC, I wouldn't be here. I mean, just the weightlifting and the mental toughness Coach Evans used to pound in your head every day. You know, everything now is just easy.
Fortson is now 15 pounds lighter than he was in college, and he doesn't look like such a big guy anymore. In fact, he seems happy not to be the go-to guy, not to be the center of attention.
Yeah, I like it now, you know, I'm just an average player and trying to work hard to be a great player one day.
That's the thing that hasn't changed about Fortson. He knows there's work to be done, and he's more than willing to do it.
Gary, we see Danny Fortson and others already in the NBA, and the scouts keep showing up at Xavier and UC games looking for more players.
No question about it. At Xavier games, there have been more scouts than ever before. Tom Heiser's issue, and he's running out of passes. He's got to get the printing press going. But most of them this year have come to see James Posey, Terray Braggs, and of course Xavier's guard tandem, Gary Lumpkin and Lenny Brown, have got national press all over the country, and their seventh ranking helps that.
Give the coaches a lot of credit for bringing this talent into Cincinnati. Back up to you, DJ.
Thank you, gentlemen. Danny Fortson is just one of eight former UC and Xavier players playing in the NBA right now. In fact, three former Tri-State stars squared off just this past Monday night. Ryan Grant's Portland Trail Blazers beat the LA Lakers with Nick Van Exel. Grant, here on the Jam, is averaging 12 points a game for the Blazers. Teammate D'Antonio Wingfield, late of UC, is injured at the moment. Nick Van Exel hit five threes Monday. He's averaging 16 points and six assists for the LA Lakers. Meanwhile, teammate Corey Blunt is averaging 18 minutes, 5 points and five rebounds a game for the Lakers. In Milwaukee, ex-Musketeer Tyrone Hill is playing 35 minutes a game, averaging 9 points and seven boards a game. Derek Strong is in Orlando playing 27 minutes a game for the Magic, averaging 11 points and six rebounds. Aaron Williams is in Seattle playing 13 minutes, averaging 5 points and two boards. And there could be some future pros on the court tonight. As mentioned, already a half dozen scouts are taking a look at James Posey. Pat Cummings, you came out of UCF and went on to an 11-year NBA career. What did you have that you took to the NBA that entitled you, allowed you to play as long as you did and as well as you did?
Well, it certainly doesn't hurt to have some skill, but along with that, being physically gifted in regards to size and speed, I relied more on my skill level. I wasn't able to run as fast or jump as high as most players, but just being mentally prepared and being possibly getting with the right team and just basically having that opportunity to play.
What is Danny Fortson going through right now, these early months of his NBA career?
Well, he's going through a big learning process right now. He's with the team that's not winning a lot of basketball games. There's a lot of pressure on the coaching staff and the players. I think the thing that Danny needs to do is just stay focused, keep his head on, go to practice every day, work hard, go out and produce. Danny's going to be real successful. The more minutes he gets, the more productive he's going to be. And Denver's the type of team, they're in the rebuilding, and they're going to be better 2 and 3, 4 years down the road.
Now, Ralph Lee, you took a different career track. Did you realize that you did not have the skill, or did you not choose to pursue it in the NBA?
Well, what I did, Danny, is I looked at my options when I got out of school. One of the things I was looking forward to was a draft to see if I got drafted. And if I did get drafted, then I would pursue it. But if I didn't, I'd always said, even when they recruited me, that if I didn't get drafted, as long as I had my degree, I would go out and start working.
And you're still staying close to the game. Obviously, you are one of our sports of all sorts, basketball correspondents, and you're still coaching.
Yes, still coaching at Mount Healthy High School, doing the sports of all sorts, and also working at ComEd.
And keeping track of Tri-State alumni in the pros and in the college level, for that matter, is getting easier all the time thanks to the Internet. Musketeer and Bearcat fans can get up-to-the-minute updates on all their favorite alums. In fact, keeping track of current teams has never happened more closely than it is happening now. Channel 9's Bob Holtzman made the leap into cyberspace to check out the Bearcats and Muskies on the web.
They're going nuts at Miami. The Redhawks beat the seventh-ranked Musketeers 80-72.
They get 20 seconds on ESPN, maybe a line or two in a national newspaper. So how do the Tri-State Titans make sure fans can keep up? Cincinnati may have Channel 9's nothing but net, but outside the Tri-State, fans have to turn to everything on the web.
We've got season preview, all the player information, roster, latest releases, latest news.
Cyberspace is where it's at these days. Both Xavier and UC operate web pages where fans can keep up with the Musketeers and the Bearcats. They let fans get the latest box scores, player profiles, even leap off to other sites to check out how they're doing in the polls. UC's webpage operator, Scott Kuykendall, says the sites are especially popular for out-of-town fans.
If the game's not on ESPN or if they can't see it on TV, they want to know how they did, and they don't want to wait till the paper the next morning or to try and find it from some other way, and they know they can check our website now because we update it continuously on a daily basis after the game, before the game.
The teams even get an extra boost from the hometown fans. This Xavier website fans out across the world from a basement in Delhi. Randy Witt and his son Chris operate Chris and Randy's unofficial Musketeer homepage.
But a lot of people have homepages of their hobbies or their favorite something. And, you know, the thing that we like to do best was watch Xavier basketball. So that's how it actually evolved.
Chris and Randy are Xavier season ticket holders. They update their homepage just as soon as they get home from the games. Chris says operating the page makes him feel closer to the Musketeers.
Because I know, like, I can, like, somebody asked me how somebody's doing, I can tell them how, like, all their statistics and everything's got right off the top of my head.
So fans benefit, but this isn't just about the fans, it's about the future.
If you can tell a recruit, hey, if you can't make a visit here, check out our website, see a little bit about not only athletics, but the school in general, the city, all that kind of stuff. We've got the link to the conference office, NCAA, all kinds of different stuff that you can access after you come through our site.
Thank you, Bob. Getting to the Xavier and UC websites is easy enough. www.xavier.edu and www.ucdotedu.edu. Now for Chris and Randy's page, go to members.aol.com/Randall33/. Now, Ralph and Pat, growing up in Baltimore and you growing up in Pennsylvania, how did you keep your families apprised of what you were doing with your respective careers?
I tell you what, we were heard on the radio. My mom used to listen to the game on the radio all the time on WLW. But I tell you, the biggest thing they used to do is always send the press clippings after the game. The sports information director like Isaac, he'd get them out right after the game. She knew exactly what was going on.
How about you? Back when you played, it was smoke signals and teletype, wasn't it?
Well, I think with my family, they lived on no-dos. I can probably maybe a couple handful of times that they didn't see a home game at the University of Cincinnati, either at the Coliseum or, and they were at a lot of games.
They put a lot of miles on.
Certainly was.
They love you, big boy. And why not? Who doesn't? You know, of course, you've already clicked on the fastest access to this year's shootout. UC says it's ready to soar, while the Muskies are looking to prove they can take the Cats' best shot. Up next, we'll look at the game ahead. We'll take a look back at Xavier's Garden highlights and have another round of trivia. Yes, the energy is building as we return to the Cincinnati Gardens. In just a few minutes, Xavier tips off against the UC Bearcats looking for its 10th straight home win. Now, do you know the last team to beat Xavier here at the Gardens? It was Duquesne last January. And right now, we test our crosstown wits again. Michael Flannery joins us live again from the Blue Moon Saloon in Hyde Park. Michael?
Denny, I have to thank you. I don't get to work with sports that often. But whenever I do, I get to hang out in a bar. So, boy, I'm loving my job. Right now, I'm with Mark Reichert, a UC grad, 1996, and Jim Bothan, an XU grad, 1965, who played with the Muskies from 61 through 65. Are you guys ready for the last two tickets? All right, here we go. Here's your first question. How many teams are in the Atlantic 10? Mark, don't break anything, okay? Please. Go ahead. How many teams?
10, 11.
The choices are 10, 11, or 12?
12.
That is correct. Mark, you have the first point. Don't worry, Jim, the next one's easy. Okay, question number two. Where did the nickname Bearcats come from? Was it a former academic dean's pet, a classic car, or a football player? Jim?
Football player.
That is correct. Tie score. That was 1914, a running back, Leonard Teddy Bear. Here's the last question. You nervous?
No.
Liar. Okay, here we go. Who won the last two crosstown shootouts? Choice A, will you wait a minute? Choice A, the visiting team, or B, the home team?
Visiting team. What? Visiting team.
That is correct. And we have a winner for two tickets right here. Thank you very much. Shaking hands. And don't forget to watch Know-It-Alls tonight at 11:35. Jim, thank you very much. Appreciate that. Mark, way to go. Back to you, Denny.
Thank you very much, Michael. The Gardens continues to fill up for the 1997 Skyline Chili Crosstown Countdown. Our man in the crowd is Dave Lapham. Dave?
Thanks a lot, DJ. You know, part of the tradition of the Crosstown Shootout is face painting. And over here, we've got Jennifer Woodrig out of Mount Vernon, Ohio, a senior at Xavier. Jennifer, who sponsors this face painting deal?
Xavier Athletic Department and our Education Club.
The Education Club. And here getting his face painted with us right now is 9-year-old Patrick Early. Patrick, who's going to win this game?
Xavier.
Xavier, what's the score going to be?
100-0.
100-0. A very optimistic fan. And of course, you know, we get faces painted of all ages right here. Amanda Malloy, a local gal out of Anderson, Ohio, also a senior at Xavier, is painting the face of 4-month-old Shannon. Shannon's a Xavier fan, I take it?
She's a big Xavier fan.
Is this, obviously, this is her first of many Crosstown shootouts, I gather.
That's right. She'll be here for the next 18 years, I think.
And is this the youngest face that you've ever painted, Amanda?
I think so.
Any more pressure with dealing with a 4-month-old?
No.
Okay, well, you know, guys, like I said, face painting, it's of all ages. We got a couple of wild men here. Not only paint their face, check this out. DJ, they paint their entire body. All right, fill us in. First of all, give us your name and what class you're in here at Xavier.
I'm Eric Newcomer. I'm from Colorado, and I'm a freshman here at Xavier.
Freshman at Xavier. How about you?
Tim Toomey. I'm a freshman. I'm from New York.
Okay, we got Colorado, we got New York. One question each. How long does it take you to put this all this paint on? How long does it take?
About a half hour.
About a half an hour. And more importantly, how long does it take to get it off?
About 45 minutes to an hour.
45 minutes to an hour. Obviously, Xavier today, how many points, guys?
I think they're going to win by 30.
40. What are you?
40. Couple of very enthusiastic fans here, DJ. Back to you guys.
Fans or Smurfs, you take your pick, Dave. Just about 20 minutes to game time now, and we have to ask what kind of last-minute strategizing is going on. When we come back, we'll take a look at the 1997 Musketeers and Bearcats and how they match up. We're back live at the Cincinnati Gardens. Ralph Lee and Pat Cummings joining yours truly, Dennis Jansen. Let's break this game down. Let's have some matchups here, Pat. Let me ask you this. My contention is that with Danny Fortson gone, UC has the opportunity to perhaps do more with less this year. You have an All-American like Danny Fortson. You want to design as many plays as you can to utilize his talents. Now Bob Huggins has 5 opportunities. Wouldn't you agree that there's going to be a more diversified offense?
I think they're certainly spreading the wealth more this year. Bobby Brannon has stepped up, Juwan Baker, and you'll have some big nights out of Melvin Levitt. I think the key tonight is how UC handles Xavier's three-headed monster. And what I mean by that is the backcourt, ball and defensive pressure from Brown, Lumpkin, and Williams.
And I'll tell you what, Lenny Brown is the genuine article. Who can they send out there to cover him? Because he really makes things happen for the Musketeers.
Well, Horton's going to be key tonight. Because he, number one, he has to bring the ball up the court and set up the offense, but also he has to try to slow down Brown so they can't get into their offensive sense as quickly and as comfortably as they'd like to.
Now, Ralph Lee, we talk about Juwan Baker. He might be the X factor, pardon the pun, for UC, because frankly, the Xavier Musketeers haven't had an opportunity to play against this guy a whole lot, and he's really stepped up for UC.
Yeah, that's going to be a key, Denny. If he's stepped up this year and he's averaging in the high double figures, he has to do a better job today to handle those guards of Xavier. Juwan is going to be put in the situation first time on the road in a hostile environment. He's been putting up big numbers in the past. We've got to see how he handles that situation here today, because it's the first Crosstown where he's going to be asked to put in a lot of points.
And you know what, when you talk to Bob Huggins, Juwan Baker is one of the guys that he talks about as exhibiting a tremendous work ethic. The kid really cares, has a lot of heart.
He does have a lot of heart. Juwan Baker exhibits all the things that Bob Huggins teaches as far as heart, as far as getting the job done when asked to step up in special situations. In the past, he hasn't had to have that situation where he had to step up and score a lot. He's had a lot of scores around him.
Speaking of guys with heart, big men, big heart, who have stepped up in a big way, Bobby Brannon for UC. He has really come to shine, hasn't he?
He's been really impressive this year. He worked hard over the summer, got stronger, learned how to do the little up and under. He's a hard worker. He's going to bang you all night. He's the type of player that's going to be a big factor in this game. He must stay out of foul trouble, and he must have a solid performance for UC to have a chance.
And I think it all boils down to the fact that we are about to enjoy one whale of a basketball game. The Musketeers and Bearcats men continue to get national attention, but we have to let you know what is going on with this respective women's basketball programs. The Lady Bearcats are off to a fantastic start. Coach Laurie Pirtle has them at 5-0. They play next tomorrow at Dayton. Against Dayton, make that. Coach Melanie Balcom and her Lady Musketeers in action at Schmidt Field House this afternoon. However, they lost to Butler 72-61. That brings their season record to 4-3. Well, as mentioned, the Crosstown Shootout seldom disappoints. But where do they rank in terms of the Garden's greatest games? When we come back, we'll take a look at Xavier's history at the Gardens and some of the greatest games and greatest memories of this venerable old basketball emporium. Again, everyone, we're back at the Gardens, and not surprisingly, tonight's game is a sellout. The crowd is already buzzing. In fact, I have it on good authority that they have worked themselves up into a well-lubricated lather. Our man on the sidelines sampling the brew is Dave Lapham. David. Yo, Dave. Dave can't hear because of the band.
Here we go, down here on the court side with one of the legends of Xavier University basketball, point guard Jamal Walker. Xavier star from 87 to 91. And Jamal, let me take you back to January 31st of 1991. You hit that game-winning three-pointer. What was that like?
I'm standing right in the corner where I was at. Felt good, you know. Came out with a W, and it was an exciting time. And, you know, we went on to go to the Sweet 16 that year, so, you know, it came out, you know, for the best.
Now, let me ask you, a lot of people know who the stars of this game are. In your mind, who has to step up? Who's the guy, the unknown, that may play a big, big role in this basketball game for their respective teams?
Well, like you said, I think DeJuan Baker for UC is the main guy that you're going to look at, and Bobby Brandon. But I think if Kenyon Martin for UC can step up a little bit, you know, take the pressure off, and plus the guards for UC. They got to be able to handle the pressure that Xavier's going to throw at them. For Xavier, you just got to have consistency. The guys you have, the top seven, the top eight guys, you know, you always know who's going to come and play for these guys. But if you have a couple of other guys, Nate Turner or DJ Johnson, step up, hit some shots, you know, make it better for the other guys, take some pressure off, then we have a good game. We're going to have a good game regardless. It's just hard to predict as far as the Xavier UC game because, you know, somebody shows up that you never could say, you know, this guy was there, but he never was there before.
I guess, how big is the Crosstown Shootout? How big are the bragging rights in this basketball game?
The city of Cincinnati is unbelievable. You know, nobody in America knows about this game. I think last year was ridiculous. They had somebody winning by 17 points. I think UC was winning by 17 points. This game here is for everybody here, you know, the atmosphere. The city of Cincinnati knows each player on the team. You know, go out here and have fun with it. You know, that's how I look at it.
Well, guys, from a guy that knows, this is a big one. Back to you guys.
Thank you very much, Dave and Janelle. I got an early start this morning. I was down at Northern Kentucky University. Our old friend Nick Clooney was conferred with an honorary doctorate degree, and from the time I walked into the proceedings until the time I left, I went to Skyline and Kenwood on the way over here. People all over town peppering me with questions. Who's going to win this game? Who's going to win this game? I'm sure you've been getting the same.
All week long. What's going to take for them to win this game? How are they going to handle the pressure, Ralph? What do you think are the keys? We've been getting peppered all week long. In about 20 minutes, we can put all those questions aside because it's going to be decided down there between the white lines.
Pat, any thoughts? I know people look to you because they say, hey, not only what's going to happen today, but which of these guys is going to go to the NBA?
I like James Posey a lot for the Xavier Musketeers. I think he's very talented. He runs the floor very well, handles the ball. I think if he can get a little stronger, put on some weight, and expand his shooting range, I think he's as talented as a guy as there is in college basketball right now.
Of course. Now, you two gentlemen contributed to your own special moments in the Crosstown Shootout. Tonight actually marks the 201st time Xavier will take the Gardens floor since making the Gardens their official home in 1983. So we thought we would take a look back in time at some Gardens memories from 14 incredible, memorable seasons.
It's been the launching pad for NBA careers and provided a lifetime of memories.
Last but not least, I'd like to thank you, all the fans, for all your support and making me feel so good, even after I graduated. Thanks a lot. I love you, and I'll cherish this night for the rest of my life. Thank you.
Cincinnati Gardens has been a fertile field of dreams when it comes to Musketeer basketball. Did you know that Xavier posted two big NIT victories in the Gardens? In the spring of 1984, they beat Ohio State and Nebraska 4 days apart to make the quarterfinals. Of course, they haven't all been wins. Last year, the Musketeers had a chance to topple the number one team in America. But the last-second try to beat UMass failed. Musketeers lost in overtime.
We just let it slip through our fingers. I guess we should have had it.
I mean, I'm always proud of them. I mean, I know they're gonna leave everything out on the floor. I feel badly for them. I've coached 20 years, maybe, whatever it is, and I might coach 20 more, but this was certainly
a splendid opportunity for them to do something that hadn't been done by anybody in the country this year.
The Gardens has hosted enough shootout memories to last forever.
Xavier with tough pressure. Davenport all over the back.
There was the 1990 no-call game. Xavier won when Lou Banks was stripped in the final seconds. And in 1994, there was no handshake to end one of the best shootouts ever.
It was like a boxing match where, at the end of 15 rounds, it was a dead tie and you had to go another round.
That 1994 shootout was tied at the half and tied at the end of regulation after Brian Grant turned an air ball into a second chance.
It was floating, and I saw Bostic there. He was all ready to grab it in the game. I just jumped in there, snatched it, and put it in.
The Musketeers took the 1994 game 82-76. But the biggest shootout at the Gardens didn't involve UC. In January of 1990, Paul Westhead brought his Loyola Marymount Lions to town. Their philosophy was to shoot within 7 seconds, and they had marquee players like Hank Gathers and Bo Kimble.
You know, they outscore you in the National. They play Vegas. They play Oakland. You know, they're on national TV more than, you know, Leave It to Beaver.
The Muskies and Lions got after it for 2 hours, and when the dust settled, they had set the Gardens record for most points scored, 228 points. That's a point every 10 seconds. And it was the last 10 seconds that made the difference.
11 seconds to go. Final 9 seconds of this game. Jamal Walker looking up at the clock. 5 seconds. Little razzle dazzle goes up, throws it up, hits it. He hit it. No time left on the clock.
That's the ball game.
Musketeers have won it.
Your record in Crosstown shootouts, Ralph?
I was 3-1 in the Crosstown shootout. Lost my first game and then won 3 straight.
And Mr. Perfecto?
4-0 at my career at UC, but I can't remember a game that was a double-digit win, so it's going to be a very competitive basketball game this evening also.
Thank you very much. Folks, stay right there. We'll be right back with one final scene setter before tonight's game. Down clock on the wall shows us that there are precious few minutes before the tip-off of the 1997 Skyline Chili Crosstown Shootout. Time for us to shift around on our broadcast position here and get ready for game coverage. We want to thank you for joining our Crosstown Countdown. We also want to thank Ralph Lee and Pat Cummings. We're going to ask you gentlemen to stick around and provide some analysis at halftime of the game and also post-game. We would also like to thank our coordinating producer, Pete Genovis, and special salute to our director, Phyllis Parker. With that, we're going to move out of the way with some music inspired by the shootout's move to Saturday night. Everyone enjoy the action. We'll see you at halftime.
could you feel soaked with the tears because a baby's life has been revoked? The bond is broke, got so choke up and foe. Kiss on the clothes of Mr. Wizard, can't reform. No God like Hocus Pocus, so don't sit back, kick back and watch the world get bushwhacked. News and ten, your neighborhood is under attack. Put away the crack before the crack put you away. You need to be there when your baby's old enough to relay.
From ABC9, this is Xavier Basketball. Live from the Cincinnati Gardens, it's the Cincinnati Bearcats versus the Xavier Musketeers.
The countdown is over. The Gardens is filled up and fans are getting ready because it's game time. Good evening, everyone. John Popovich, along with a veteran of three of these Crosstown shootouts, Gary Massa. And Gary, we thought we had this all figured out. Then Xavier makes this little trip over to Oxford this week, gets knocked off by a good Miami team.
That's what makes college basketball so fantastic. They had a tough time up there. The Musketeers have lived and died by that pressure defense. We've talked about it a long time. They like that offense to come out of that defense. And the Miami Redhawks handled that pressure defense. You can see the Musketeers are 5-1. They're ranked 7th in the country. That'll come down a little bit, even if they beat the Bearcats tonight. But one of the reasons they're playing so well is the fact that they use that pressure defense to force 28 turnovers a game. When you force turnovers like that, you can shoot a high field goal percentage. Musketeers at 52% for the year.
The UC Bearcats playing very well, although some of the fans think they should be playing better, but they've learned to expect great things from this program.
Well, Bob Huggins has done such a tremendous job with that program. He's got their fans' expectations to be in the tournament, to be nationally ranked every year. They are 4-1, and they're playing very well, but they're not nationally ranked. Their last three games, they have beaten their opponent by an average of 23 points. One of the reasons they're playing so well is the fact that they average more than 11 more rebounds per game than their opponent. But, John, this is their first road game, and it's in a hostile environment. It's a crosstown shootout. It'll be fun to watch.
A lot of guys playing well for Xavier, but one of the most consistent, James Posey.
James Posey's just been fantastic this year for the Musketeers. He comes off the bench, and you can see 17 points a game. He leads the Muskies in rebounding at almost 10 rebounds a game, and he's averaging 57% from the field. He is a guy that the Bearcats are going to have to slow down tonight.
Meanwhile, the guy for the Bearcats, he's a local kid, so he knows what this is all about. Bobby Brandon has come a long way.
Bobby Brandon is a local kid, as you mentioned. He is going to be fired up. Big, strong, aggressive player. He's been asked to do a lot more by Coach Huggins this year, and he's responded. 21 points a game, 11 rebounds, and he's really taken the ball to the hoop. Done a great job from the free throw line, 91% from that. Musketeers and the Bearcats are in for a war, and the Musketeers are going to have to stop Brandon and Juwan Baker tonight.
It's getting loud in here, and it's getting very hot. We'll be back with the opening setup, the Crosstown Shootout, Xavier against UC, right after.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Cincinnati Gardens for the Skyline Crosstown Shootout between the University of Cincinnati Bearcats and your Xavier University Musketeers. And now let's meet this evening's starting lineups. First, for the University of Cincinnati Bearcats, a 6'3 junior forward from Cleveland, number 21, Melvin Levitt. A 6'7 senior forward from Cincinnati, number 34, Bobby Brannon. A 6'8 sophomore center from Dallas, number 4, Kenyon Martin. A 6'1 junior guard from Alexandria, Virginia, number 11, Michael Horton. And a 6'2 senior guard from Fort Worth, number 5, DeJuan Baker. Head coach for the Bearcats is Bob Huggins. He is assisted by Rod Baker, Mick Cronin. Xavier University Musketeers. A 6'4 junior forward from Brooklyn, number 32, Darnell Williams. A 6'7 senior forward from Charlotte, number 21, T.J. Johnson. A 6'8 senior center from Fresno, California, number 33, Torrey Bragg. A 6'2 junior guard from Wilmington, Delaware, number 4, Lenny Brown. And a 6'2 junior guard from Newcastle, Delaware, number 12, Gary Lumpkin. Xavier's head coach is Skip Prosser. His assistants are Mark Schmidt, Jeff Battle, and Michael Davenport.
We are ready for the Skyline Chili Crosstown Shootout. Let's take a look at the starting lineups, sponsored by your local Chrysler Plymouth dealer. Being first roll for the Cincinnati Bearcats, there you see Levitt and Brannon. Kenyon Mark, the big guy in the middle. DeJuan Baker, the big scorer. And Michael Horton, who will run the team. Meanwhile, for the Xavier Musketeers, T.J. Johnson, the only, the senior on the unit, along with Torrey Braggs. And then a trio of juniors in Darnell Williams, Lenny Brown, and Gary Lumpkin, all three who have seen now, this is their third Crosstown Shootout. A lot of emotion already expended here, Gary Massa.
Yeah, we heard that Bobby Brannon turned his ankle in warm-ups. That's how intense this game is, John.
Even the warm-ups are tough.
Now he turned his ankle. He's going to play. He got it okay from the doctor, but apparently he turned his ankle a little bit in the warm-ups. There you see a good shot of the Crosstown Trophy. Boy, it's amazing what this game has meant over the years, and there's a guy that's really brought the Musketeer program along in a great way, Skip Prosser. He and Bob Huggins have brought a new flavor, intensity to this already wicked rivalry.
Martin and Brenner and Braggs jump it. It goes to the UC Bearcats, and Michael Horton with the ball in his hands into Brannon, top of the key, and a whistle right off the bat underneath, and Torrey Braggs gets hit with an early foul 8 seconds into this contest.
John, that doesn't surprise me at all. Both of these teams are known for physicalness inside, aggressive play. Referees want to get this thing under control early.
T.J. Johnson guarding Bobby Brannon, trying to turn on him. A fake goes up, and a foul called on T.J. Johnson. So here we have 14 seconds gone in this game. Already two fouls called on the Musketeers. Today's officials, Tom Lopes, Larry Lembo, and Joe DeMeo. Kevin Martin gets the inbounds pass, looking into Brannon. Brannon outside, kicks it out, now to Levitt. He takes a shot, a three-pointer off the front of the rim. Braggs with the rebound. Lumpkin loses the handle momentarily as the Musketeers take the offense for the first time on defense, committing two fouls, but keeping the Musketeers out of the basket, keeping the Bearcats out of the basket. Brannon with the steal comes down against T.J. off the glass and in, and Bobby Brannon hits the first two of the evening.
Great steal. The big guy gets a steal, goes the full length of the court.
And you probably already noticed brand new uniforms for the Musketeers, kind of a grayish or a dirty white, showing them off first time here in one of their biggest games of the year. Lumpkin. Darnell Williams, he's too hard. Bragg bounces it, gets it back, fires it back to Lumpkin, shoots it over to Williams. Williams a couple of dribbles and goes inside, and he's fine.
Melvin Levitt got caught holding Darnell Williams. A little bit of a mismatch with Levitt. Both Darnell Williams and when James Posey comes in, there's going to be a mismatch from the size standpoint.
Lumpkin into Brown to fake, goes to Brannon. Now takes it to the baseline, goes up, and he gets hacked. And once again, it's going to be Mel Levitt.
Melvin Levitt trying to help out on the weak side.
Apparently, Merrill didn't get whistled for that first one. This is counted as the first foul against him. You see, he gets way up there. The only problem is he was on Lenny Brown's back.
Huggins dishing out a couple of cents to an official who puts his hand up like, stop it right now. Musketeers get a couple. Now they apply the full court pressure. Horton with the ball, throws ahead to Kenyon Martin. Martin to Levitt. Levitt hits from 10 feet away. That,
John, that's what you want to do against the Musketeer pressure. Got to make them pay for it. Attack the pressure, get an easy bucket.
Minute and a half gone in this contest. 4-2 lead for the Bearcats. Lenny Brown lets loose a three and hits it.
Lenny Brown is a big-time player. He'll show up in the big games.
Brannon looking for help to Horton, loses his dribble for a second. Now he looks for help, and a timeout is called by the Bearcats facing that pressure.
And this, John, this place is going crazy. We talked about the pressure defense. That's exactly what the Musketeers want to do. They're really going to make Michael Horton prove it. Michael Horton has heard it all week long about the two Musketeer guards. They're going to make him prove he can handle that pressure.
Stay tuned at halftime when we'll present the Dodge halftime report. Bob Holtzman's back at the station. He's going to recap the first half and keep you up to date on the rest of the hoops action from this afternoon. Probably have highlights from that Kentucky game. They had a pretty convincing win over Georgia Tech earlier this afternoon. 5-4 Xavier in the early going. 18:01 to go in this first half of play.
We're told that Bob Huggins was warned on that last altercation with the referee about a technical.
Again, difficulty getting the ball inbounds.
Musketeers forcing close to 28 turnovers a game.
UC tried to call the timeout, didn't get it. Lenny Brown outside to Lumpkin. Lumpkin lets loose the three, skims over the rim and out of bounds. Levitt went up in the air, and he got knocked down.
John, have you ever seen anybody shoot like Melvin Levitt? I mean, jump like Melvin Levitt.
It's levitation.
He's told he's got a 39-inch vertical leap.
Brannon guarded by Lumpkin, again looking for help. Now throws it to Kenyon Martin. It's knocked away by the Musketeers. Here comes Bragg down to Lumpkin, and a foul is called. Here we see it. Brannon letting loose, and the ball is knocked away on route to... And Bragg's went to get it, and I think he was handcuffed at that point. 5-4 Xavier. And again, bodies banging all over the place. The ball is knocked out of bounds. Bob Huggins says that's our ball, but the officials disagree.
This pressure defense, John, was the talk of the week. Again, Michael Horton, he's got kind of a high dribble. You cannot dribble through that kind of pressure anyway. You really got to make the passes. And so far, the Bearcats, bigger people, have not come to meet the ball.
Pass it to Lumpkin underneath, and he lays it in. Into Brannon. DeJuan Baker's now come down to help out. Horton fires it aside. It's deflected, but gets its way to Kenyon Martin, and DeJuan Baker picks it up. So the Bearcats, after about three unsuccessful trips down the court, trying to set up their offense, does it, and a nice shot by Horton.
Horton shows a little bit of his prowess in the half-court offense. A great crossover move all the way to the bucket. Look at the crossover dribble. Something's become so popular in both NBA and college. Crossover all the way down the lane. And Darnell Williams, you can see, got caught leaning the other way. TJ Johnson tried to help out a little bit too late.
Michael Horton, the 6'1 junior out of Alexandria, Virginia, averaging 6 points a game and six assists per game. He was kept out of the Elkhorn State game because he wasn't playing real well, but that one seemed to open up his eyes. And the Xavier Musketeers and the UC Bearcats tied at seven. Lumpkin out to Braggs. He has to reach for that one. Now gets it back to Lump.
Bearcats are back. Looks like a little zone, a little 1-2-2 zone. Something Bob Huggins doesn't like to do. You can tell that he wants to slow this ball game down a little bit. Make the Musketeers shoot from outside.
10 seconds on the shot clock as the ball goes into Brown. Now it goes inside to Braggs. He loses it. Tried to kick it back out, but he traveled with it. And it'll become the Bearcats' ball.
I would imagine that Coach Huggins is going to try to make the Musketeers beat him from outside.
pack it in a little bit and try to rebound.
Baker fires it down to Levitt. Levitt goes up very high to get it. Now cross court back to Dewan Baker. Baker, an outstanding shooter. Now to Levitt. Levitt on the wing, guarded by Lumpkin. Side to Baker, and they swing it around to Horton. Horton to Brannon. 15 seconds on the shot clock for the Bearcats, and it's taken away. Here comes Lumpkin leading the charge. Rags with the left hand, turns, spins, and hits off the glass. The defense falls down. Lumpkin slips. That allows the Bearcats to move the ball a little more quickly. Up, Horton has an opening bounce pass inside. Darnell Williams scoots it away. He picks it up. He brings it down. One on three. Back outside. Lumpkin. Lumpkin tries a three.
Lumpkin's had a tough time from the three-point mark up until that shot. He's had a little bit of a drought over the last three games, just 25%.
Biggest lead for anybody, 12-7 now for the Musketeers. Horton operating the offense to Levitt in the right corner. Inside, Darnell Williams and Kenyon Martin, a lot of leaning on each other. Martin picks up the missed shot. Outside to Horton, shoots it over to Levitt. Levitt tries from the right side and hits it. Lenny Brown going in and quickly beats the Bearcats down the court. Bob Huggins goes real quickly and gets Ryan Fletcher off the bench. Somebody missed an assignment.
One of the keys for the Bearcats is to get back in transition defense. Looks like Kenyon Martin or Bobby Brannon didn't get back. He's going to put Fletcher in.
Fletcher ready to come in, as is James Posey, the super sub for the Musketeers. This is Levitt now backtracking a little bit with Darnell Williams on him. Set up Michael Horton, goes behind Kenyon Martin. Now he backs up a little bit. 6 seconds on the shot clock now for the Bearcats. 4 seconds. Horton lets it go too hard. Rebound pulled off by Brannon. Good hustle there by Bobby Brannon. And a foul on Torrey Bragg.
Bobby Brannon has come such a long way, John. He's fought and worked so hard. A lot of people say he exemplifies what Bob Huggins' teams are all about. It's worked real tough, averaging 11 rebounds a game, and a lot of those come on the offensive end.
We have a timeout on the floor. Xavier leading the UC Bearcats 14-9. The UC Bearcats. Let's take a look at a Kroger action replay. And here you see Bobby Brannon giving chase. Bring the ball up court. Boy, I tell you what, he has learned how to do so many things over 4 years at UC, and he pulls it up nicely.
And we said the fact that Reuben Patterson being out of and Bearcats through some adversity are asking him to step up and play a lot more minutes and be a lot more a part of the game, and he's done just that. He's answered the call, over 20 points a game, 11 rebounds, and really, really improved his game.
There you saw some percentages for the early shooting. Both teams shooting very well, although the Musketeers on fire right now. 14-9 they lead, 14-41 mark. James Posey now enters the Musketeers lineup along with Pat Kelsey. So right now for the Musketeers, it'll be Braggs, Darnell Williams, Lumpkin, Kelsey, and James Posey.
John, the Musketeers have 12 points from their guards, Lumpkin with 5 and Lenny Brown with 7. That means their pressure is working. They're shooting 5 of 7 from the field, 71%. That's when you know that their pressure is making it happen for them.
Kenyon Martin has taken a seat on the bench now for the UC Bearcats. Ryan Fletcher has entered the game as he fights with James Posey trying to get open, and he does get the inbounds pass. He's in the corner, fires back out to Horton. Horton looking around. Battling against Kelsey, backs it back up. Baker. Baker looked for the shot, didn't get it as Darnell Williams had good defense, and Braggs works his way down, and he's fouled by Melvin Levitt.
John, you saw Juwan Baker a little bit frustrated. He's a guy that's got the green light. Coach Huggins lets him shoot. He's averaging 26 points a game, 30 and 33 in his last two outings. He just got frustrated and gave it up. Torrey Braggs takes it. You saw Bobby Brannon take it to the whole court prior, and there you see Torrey Braggs.
Brent Petras comes into the game, of course, the former UC football quarterback who was a receiver this past season and was a walk-on on the squad. He comes in for Mel Levitt. So Levitt has two fouls. T.J. Johnson, and this was my mistake earlier, T.J. Johnson is the Musketeers player with two personal fouls instead of Torrey Braggs.
And the fact that Petras is in the game gives you an idea that Sean Myrick's stress fracture is not doing well. He's usually the second point guard that comes in. Instead, the football player, former quarterback and a wide receiver, into the game for the Bearcats.
This is Fletcher inside, trying to turn, tries to go up between two men, and he gets a foul called on Pat Kelsey.
I'll tell you, the play inside is incredibly aggressive right now. We saw the two quick early fouls to try to maintain some control by the referees. The guys are banging in the paint right now.
Ryan Fletcher going to the line, the 6'8 sophomore out of Middletown High School, averaging 4 points per game, 2.2 rebounds. Had a hand injury last year, which pretty much kept him out of everything except a couple of games. Then he had a stress fracture in his left leg. That was in the preseason, so I don't think we really know what Ryan Fletcher could do just because he's had so many problems with injuries.
Coaches did say he worked out. He put on 40 pounds and grew an inch and a half over the offseason. Just got a little rusty from sitting out the season.
Free throw shooter, 45%, but he was zero that time down the court, so the Musketeers maintain the 5-point lead. Bounce pass to Williams. Williams inside to Braggs, outside to Kelsey. He's open for a moment. Lumpkin in the corner. He'll try it, and he goes off the side of the rim. Baker with the rebound. Ahead to Horton. Horton against Kelsey. Knocks off to Fletcher, but he misses the stop.
We just talked about the fact he's a little bit rusty. He's put on some weight. Put on.
Take a look at this. Fletcher goes up.
Might not be in the shape that he normally would be in, and maybe that's the reason he missed it. You can see Bob Huggins really getting after him.
Immediately pulls him from the game. He puts Kenyon Martin back in.
Let's tell him, get the 2 points. Make sure you get the two.
So the Bearcats have had chances the last two times down the court to produce 4 points. Two from the free throw line and one on that stuff. And they can't get it, and they stay back by five.
Torrey Braggs took a foul. That's his second. So kind of buried his shoulder into Kenyon Martin.
The problem for big guys right off the bat, Torrey Braggs has two, and he leaves the game, but T.J. Johnson comes in. He already has two personal fouls.
Musketeers stay in the full court pressure.
Here's Horton, guarded by two. Now he gets around. A nice little move by Michael Horton, but he throws ahead over the head of Kenyon Martin. When you throw over Kenyon Martin's head, you're doing something.
That's seven turnovers of Musketeers cause. Give Pat Kelsey a lot of credit. He put a lot of heat on Michael Horton.
Both teams have slowed down as far as putting the ball in the basket. Darnell Williams, top of the key, tries the left-handed dribble outside to Posey. Posey to the left side to Kelsey. Now he brings it back out.
Bearcats stay in the 2-3 zone. Trying to slow it down a little bit.
10 seconds on the shot clock. Lenny Brown, right side. 5 seconds. Brown takes it in over to Williams. Williams lets it go from three-point range way off the mark. And now here come the Bearcats. This is Horton. Musketeers get back real well, and we have a foul called on Pat Kelsey, his second.
See if Pat moved his feet a little bit. Michael Horton, so quick. Look at the little stutter step. Yep, slid his feet. That's a foul.
So two fouls on Kelsey, two on T.J. Johnson, and two on Torrey Braggs.
Puts him in the bonus.
This one falls off, but it gets back in there. Peaches Chris. 14-11, Musketeers. Williams inside to Posey. Posey has to turn quickly in traffic, and he gets it back out. Musketeers moving around. Bearcats playing some awfully good defense here. And certainly they learned something from what Miami did the other night. Lenny Brown tries to go into the middle. The ball is knocked away, fought for, and Bobby Brannon has it. And a timeout is called, apparently, by Brannon on the bottom of that one.
Which means the Bearcats will keep possession. John, you mentioned Bearcats playing good defense. They're playing good, aggressive 2-3 zone defense, and the Musketeers are on a 3-minute drought so far.
Don't forget to tune in next Saturday when ABC 9 will bring you another big-time college basketball game when Xavier travels over to Indianapolis and Market Square Arena to take on the Purdue Boilermakers. They're another top 10 team. That's next Saturday, 7 o'clock, Xavier and Purdue, another ABC 9 sports production.
Almost three and a half minutes without a bucket. Give the Bearcat defense credit. And they've got the ball.
They come back out with Martin and Horton. Brandon DeJuan Baker and Brent Petrus. Martin, he's trapped, gets it ahead nice to Petrus. To Baker now, he backs it out as the Musketeers are able to get their defense down the court. So far, they've done a good job putting any clamps on DeJuan Baker, and I believe we might have something called on the Xavier bench.
It looked like a technical on Skip Prosser.
Larry Lembo was standing over there, and all of a sudden, he blew his whistle, pointed at Skip. Bobby Brannon will take the foul shot. Now that's one you don't expect. Bobby Brannon into the last game had hit 31 straight free throws. That set a new UC record. Misses on the first attempt there and cans the second. We have a timeout here at the Cincinnati Garden. Xavier 14, UC 12.
Looking for Nike this holiday? They have a...
Papa, yeah, it's loud here in the band section, but a variable in this basketball game is always officiating. The bigger the game, the bigger the variable. Will they call it tight? Will they let him play? Larry Lembo, he's officiated Final Fours. He always lets him play. Tommy Lopes, well, he calls it tight. I think the tiebreaker is going to be Joey DeMeo. Is he going to call the game tight, or is he going to let him get physical? We'll see how it unfolds, guys.
Thanks, David. Bearcats back on the floor. Let's set them for you. It's Brannon and Martin Baker and Brent Petrus and Michael Horton. Interesting stat there you had on DeJuan Baker.
DeJuan Baker averaging 26 points a game, a big part of the Bearcat offense. Just one shot, 0 points with 11 minutes left in the first half.
There you see that on the graphic that Xavier's been ice cold now for, I'm sure it's 4 minutes now. Horton dribbles down into the corner to Petrus. He fires it back out. Horton trying to put everybody in place. To Brannon. Brannon Martin from the foul line, and he dips one in.
Good little two-on-two game. Michael Horton, good job of quarterbacking the Bearcats.
Back to a tie game at 11:08 in the first half of play.
Musketeers need a little bit more ball movement against the zone. They're not going to win the game from the outside. I think that's what Coach Bob Huggins' thoughts are.
Shot clock down to 8. Darnell Williams looking for help as the Bearcats play a very tough defense. The pass across. Lumpkin goes up from the left side off the glass and in, and he's fouled.
It's a dangerous pass, but that's the way. You got to make the guys playing zone defense move their feet, get them tired. You can see Gary Lumpkin makes a good little move off the glass. Going to be going to the line.
Torrey Bragg's back in, replacing Darnell Williams on the floor for the Musketeers. And Gary Lumpkin to the line where he's an 86% shooter. Nails that one and gives the Musketeers a 3-point lead at the 10:40 mark. That allows Xavier to set up the full court pressure as well. Lumpkin all over Bobby Brannon. Now he flips ahead and is stolen by James Posey. Posey guarded by Horton. Tried to pass it over to Braggs and the ball is knocked out of bounds.
John, how many times already this year have we talked about James Posey getting in a basketball game and being active and making something happen? And there's a steal.
Lumpkin lobs in to T.J. Johnson to Lenny Brown. He's picked up. They lob to Posey. Oh, my.
And a dunk. You could see a great pass. He looked out of the corner of his eye. He saw Posey going down the baseline.
Pass down to Petras. Petras goes around T.J. Johnson and puts it in.
Give the Bearcats credit. You can see it in their eyes when they beat the press. They want to score.
Throw ahead to Posey. He can't hit this one, and the Bearcats rip away the rebound. Here come the Bearcats. Juwan Baker goes up on the left side. It's blocked. Lumpkin grabs it, then loses the handle on the ball right in front of his bench. How could I do that, he says.
Look at the steal. Usually they'll call a foul on that, but look at Lenny Brown. What a great pass. Saw him out of the corner of his eye. James Posey just continues to impress.
19-16, Musketeers. Throw a couple in there, but UC comes right back. Now Horton backs it out. Over to Kenyon Martin. He's left open. He takes the shot. This time he can't hit it. Petras chases down the rebound.
Good defense by T.J. Johnson in the inbounds play. You go over that in practice. He knew that was coming. He was right there.
Petras seeing some substantial moments as he come in from the football team. And a foul called by the Musketeers as you hear the fans groan. And it's T.J. Johnson. That's going to be his third. 9.5 minutes still to go in this first half.
Well, that's a big play, John. T.J. doesn't show up a lot in the box score. There's a lot of intangibles he does, particularly on the defensive end of the floor. You're going to miss him now for 9 minutes. He probably won't see action until the second half.
And Braggs comes on the floor. He also has three personal fouls, or two personal fouls, but he has to watch it closely. So it's Braggs and Brown, Darnell Williams back out there, along with Gary Lumpkin and James Posey.
We just saw Juwan Baker, 86% from the line, just made his first point. There's his second point of the night.
Back to a one-point game at 19-18. Lumpkin. Thought he had an opening. Horton jumped in there. Darnell Williams, one dribble, goes inside, picks it back up, puts it up, can't get it, and it is... Jeray Braggs put the big right hand up and was able to smack it in. I was surprised the basket was able to contain it. Kenyon Martin to Brannon. Brannon to Juwan Baker. Baker covered very closely. Barnard Williams inside to Brannon. Brannon off the glass too hard. Rebound pulled up by Brent Petras. Traveling called on Juwan Baker as he tried to take off.
Once again, I think Juwan Baker is just frustrated. He's used to putting the ball up 25 times a game. He's got the absolute green light from the Bearcat coaching staff. And he has not been able to get a shot off. Very well defended by the Musketeers.
21-18, Xavier, 8:45 left in this first half of play. Xavier's had five-point leads on a couple of occasions. The Bearcats just keep closing in. Lenny Brown from the side, too short. Fought for. Brown pulls it off, and a foul now called on the Bearcats. Ryan Fletcher now back into the game, replacing Kenyon Martin. Torrey Braggs will sit down, and Terrence Payne sees his first action of the afternoon. Looks like James Posey got clocked in the left eye there. Musketeers to put it in from the side to Lumpkin. Holding a three-point lead. Quick pass into Payne. Payne goes up and lays it in. But Terrence Payne into the game for about 3 seconds is able to connect and give Xavier once again its largest lead of the game, 5 points. Baker trapped, gets ahead to Petras. Petras has it knocked away. Now to Fletcher. Fletcher to Brannon. Brannon goes up, and a foul is called on the Musketeers.
Well, I like the way Petras is playing. There's a guy that plays football all year. He's not in the summer leagues. He's not working out all year round. He's in a hostile environment. He's handling his pressure pretty well, showing some of his quarterback skills.
Yeah, he really is showing a lot of poise because he's grabbed a couple of rebounds that time.
And then he did get flustered when he got the ball flattened out. He found an open man when he came back to him. You got to give him a lot of credit.
Xavier so far 3 for 3 from the line, 4 for 8. For the UC Bearcats, make it now 5 for 9. Brandon's falls off there, but look at Petrus. Charges in from the left side and sticks it back.
That's his second stick back, too, John. He's fired up playing the wing of that defense in the zone.
Darnell Williams tries the baseline, takes it in. It flips off, but it goes back in.
James Posey with the left hand.
25-21, Musketeers, back and forth we go. Michael Horton looks for Baker to Petrus, has it knocked away, but he gets it back to Ryan Fletcher, over to Horton. Horton back outside to Baker. And he has it knocked away for the second time from behind. Ahead, but Lenny Brown, Brown, and Horton goes in.
John, we have some athletes on the floor tonight. Man. These guys are running up and down, making a lot of great moves.
They are just flying. Largest lead of the game for the Musketeers, 27-21, 7:15 to go. Here's Baker. It's stolen away by Lenny Brown. Brown pulls up. Too short, and a foul's going to be called on Lenny Brown. He fouled Duan Baker.
A little bit aggressive. He was upset with himself when he made that shot, or when he tried to make the shot, came up short.
You could almost feel him getting caught up in the emotion of this, and watch him going in on this one, though.
And I'll tell you, this Xavier crowd is getting into the ball game now.
First foul on Lenny Brown as Duan Baker heads to the line. Bob Huggins talking over there to Michael Horton as Baker. That one rattles out.
The point guard position is so important. You see coaches talking to their point guard all the time. We saw Bob Huggins talking to Michael Horton. Michael Horton's been asked to play a lot from the very beginning right away. And it's a big burden for a young guy, an inexperienced guy, to come in and run the offense, run the show, especially against this kind of pressure.
Baker hits his second. And we have a timeout here at the Cincinnati Garden. Xavier on top of the UC Bearcats. We're going to take a look at a Kroger action replay and a foul shot from just moments ago. Watch Brent Petrus right in the middle of your screen come here and convert the miss. Kind of makes a certain circular around there, goes in. And the contribution from the UC Bearcats football team. Brent Petrus, a senior, 6'4 senior out of Elyria. He had 6 assists, 3 rebounds, and a basket against Moorhead. And he was an outstanding player in 3 different sports at Elyria. So he just chose football. But when Bob Huggins needed some help, he was available.
We just talked about his poise. He's got 6 points. Leads the Bearcats in scoring tonight.
And Lenny Brown tries inside once again. That ball knocked around. It's very difficult for the Musketeers to penetrate this defense.
Even though it's a zone, and it's not what Bob Huggins likes to coach. Usually he's a pressure man-to-man type coach. But he saw the type of team that the Musketeers are, especially the fact that he liked to slow it down a little bit. Let's play a little zone and make them beat us from outside. That's what he's done so far.
You know, you talked about Brent Petrus having a big night. I'm thinking about some other guys when they got in their first shootout. Michael Hawkins got in his first shootout as a freshman, had like 25 points. Darnell Williams did very well as a freshman 2 years ago. And Jackson Juleson, yep, 3 years ago, played very well for the UC Bearcats when he was pressed into service. So
James Posey came in last year. He said it was the one game that gave him the confidence to be a good player.
Pass ahead to Brandon. Brandon guarded by Lumpkin. Now he backs it toward the midcourt line, gets it over.
Boy, he's so strong, he just kind of wields guys off of him. Gary Lumpkin was trying to steal it and got swiped by that big arm of his.
While we're watching the action, let's go to Dave Lapham. Dave.
Thanks, Popo. During the break, talked about breaking that press. Bobby Brandon, a good job of it at that time. Patience is the one thing. When you pass the basketball, though, the receiver's got to come back to get the ball. Don't wait for the basketball. That's when Xavier gets their hands on a lot of them, guys.
I have no idea how Gary Lumpkin just got that pass into Terrence Payne.
It made it somehow. Let's see if we can see it. I think it's Lenny Brown leading the break.
Here's Terrence Payne has come off the bench because the big guys have trouble.
Just what you just said. Look at him thread the needle. Terrence Payne, a guy that may make a big contribution this afternoon. Already 2 buckets. Go, rebound,
good. Misses the foul shot, but the Musketeers go up by 9 in this game, 31-22. Horton gets away from him. A fight for the ball. Brannon gets it back, holds onto it. Now he turns around and fires, and it falls off the rim. Posey to Brown. Musketeers starting to set the pace a little bit now. Lumpkin fires a three.
John, when they make the three-pointer, it's got to loosen that zone up a little bit, make it a little easier to navigate in the paint.
Huge basket, a momentum shifter. And the Bearcats throw it away.
Musketeers on an 11-0 run, and a lot of those points coming off their defense. We talked about the offense coming out of the defense. They've turned the ball over 12 times, the Bearcats have, and the Musketeers have turned that into 13 points. 13 of their 34 points.
12-point lead for the Musketeers, and they could build to that right now. We have 5 minutes, 40 seconds to go in this first half of play. Lumpkin on the wing, over to Williams. Williams takes off, and now he thinks better of it. Back to Lumpkin. Long three try. He hits another one.
Watch out. Watch out if he gets the hot hand. That's two in a row.
This is when UC has to keep it together. Pinterest brings it in. Tosses to Brad Jackson, who's gem-centered the ballgame. Another football player who's played very well. Brannon bangs in, and he gets called for the charge.
Really trying to force it in and try to get a quick bucket to take the crowd out of this game. And Brannon, as you can see, there you see Jackson with a left-handed pass. Brannon gets it, and there's a charge. Bearcats get timeout.
Well, you said it earlier, first trip for the UC Bearcats into a hostile environment. They held on pretty good, but all of a sudden things have started to go against them.
And we talked about the spurt ability of the Musketeers, how what that pressure does. The score was 23-21.
Let's go to break. We'll be back right after this. Now taking a 15-point lead over the UC Bearcats. And a reminder, stay tuned at the end of today's game, and we'll be selecting the Synergy Power Play of the game. And you might just have a candidate here. Well, we're going to show you a couple in just a couple of minutes here. There's obviously some candidates as we go through that. Lenny Brown. Fans on their feet here at the Cincinnati Gardens. The Crosstown Shootout rivalry being played for the 65th time.
Here you see it, John. We talked about it before the break. The fact the Musketeers on a 14-0 run over the last 3 minutes. The score at one time was 23-21 at the 8-10 mark in the first half. Musketeers have 16 points off 13 UC turnovers.
Musketeers come back onto the floor with James Posey, Darnell Williams, Gary Lumpkin, Lenny Brown, and Payne. Sean Myrick making his first appearance now for the UC Bearcats. Dave Lapham, what do you have for us, Dave? 15-point lead now for the Musketeers. Darnell Williams, dribble in, and a whistle underneath is Brad Jackson. And Terrence Payne were mixing it up. And apparently, Brad Jackson got called for the foul, and then he said something he probably shouldn't have said.
we could hear what he said, and it was directed at Lenny Brown. Lenny Brown just kind of kept his cool. And they drew a technical.
Some things you could get away with on the football field, you can't on the basketball court.
Well, I'll tell you, you see Lenny Brown at the foul line. The backcourt for the Musketeers really lived up to its national billing so far. Lenny Brown with 11 points. Gary Lumpkin with 14 points, and he's hit two very, very crucial three-pointers.
Lenny Brown on the line, and he hits the first. As you see, Bob Huggins with Larry Limbo and Brad Jackson. Jackson, the 6'2 senior out of Akron, the co-most valuable player on the UC Bearcats Bullbound team.
Led the team in tackles, outside linebacker, 168 tackles, I believe.
Brown drops in another. And the lead keeps mounting now for the Musketeers. It's up to 17. Brown stays on the line and keeps shooting and makes it three in a row. And Limbo getting an earful from Bob Huggins.
four in a row for Lenny Brown.
That's 15 points for Lenny. Just in the first half, we got 4 minutes and 50 seconds to play.
Plus, the Musketeers have the ball, 41-22 lead, their largest, 19. A little under 5 minutes to go, Posey grabs it, pitches it back to Lumpkin. Lumpkin takes it in, bounce pass to Brown, Brown from the corner, off the mark this time, and Fletcher grabs the rebound. Again, Sean Myrick making his first appearance. He's had problems since the opener with a foot injury.
He had a stress fracture in the first game of the year.
And man out of Maysville, Kentucky, as Baker goes, loses the ball. Make it Melvin Lovett, Myrick. And this one is stolen away by Posey, and he knocks down the official right in front of us, and the Musketeers pick it back up. Posey going down the left sidelines, and the official got right in his way. I actually just couldn't get out of the way. Here's Myrick. Stolen by Williams. Here comes Williams against Baker. Williams pitches it up there.
The Musketeers are getting it done in their half-court defense right now. The Bearcats want a timeout, and this crowd is going crazy.
Timeout for the UC Bearcats. Now trailing in this game, 43-22. I want to remind you to stay tuned at the end of tonight's game when we'll be selecting the Skyline Chili star of the game. We'll be picking one player from both Xavier and Cincinnati. That's coming up at the end of tonight's game. You kind of wonder what emotional effect that Miami loss had on Xavier and whether they would be playing with this sort of intensity had they won that game on Tuesday.
John, I can tell you, when Bob Huggins saw the score, it's the worst thing that could have happened to the Bearcats, because I know that I asked Skip Prosser before the game how their practices went this week, and he said they were great. He said he felt great about his kids. He loves this group of kids, and he said their character is wonderful. They came back, and let's face it, Miami's a tough squad, and it's a tough place to play. That's what makes college basketball great.
Bobby Brannon, he brings it across midcourt, where he's picked up by two of the Musketeer defenders, ahead to Fletcher. Fletcher outside now to Michael Horton, who's back in the game. It's Horton and Brannon, Dewan Baker, Mel Lovett, and Brannon. Horton ahead to Brannon. Brannon has position, but it's blocked by Terrence Payne and a foul.
Good positioning by Bobby Brannon. He's so strong, and he uses his body very well. And you see Michael Horton set up the screen in. Bobby Brannon goes up strong. One of the great things about playing Terrence Payne so much is that you have some extra fouls to play with. If Terrence Payne can contribute, you don't have to worry about T.J. Johnson and Posey getting in foul trouble.
Brannon misses it. He is trying to end a 20-0 run on the part of the Musketeers. And Brannon, who had been perfect, a well over 90% free throw shooter, has missed a few of those tonight. Gets the second one, though. Point advantage now for the Musketeers. Let's watch the action. Let's go over to Dave Lapham. David.
Papo, during the last timeout, Xavier was talking about making the next run. They've made a nice run. Make the next one. Don't let UC make a run. They also talked about don't foul UC and let them get their legs. It looks like they're starting to labor out there. Keep the pressure on them.
And look at the legs of James Posey following up that miss with a two-handed jam. Ryan Fletcher then follows that with a three-pointer for UC.
And this is a team, Dave Lapham just mentioned, this is a Bearcat team that is not in great shape due to injuries and adversity. Guys sitting out last year. This is a team that's trying to get their legs. Sean Myrick with a bad stress factor.
Plus two guys seeing significant time there from the football
team. Exactly.
They're in shape, but they're not in basketball shape.
That's right.
Down under 2.5 minutes to go in this first half of play. The Musketeers have really shot out in front. Darnell Williams tries a three. Off balance, misses it. Brannon with the rebound. This is Horton. Horton inside to Fletcher. Nice pass by Michael Horton.
We've seen Fletcher get a little more pump, a little life into the Bearcats here. Two buckets in a row.
Bob Huggins has talked about how Michael Horton sees the floor real well. We saw it right there. Lenny Brown tries inside, backs up, bounce pass to Williams. Williams inside. Nice little maneuver.
You see the Musketeers have made a couple of three-pointers, and that makes the Bearcats play them on the perimeter more, which opens it up in the middle.
Brannon to Fletcher. Fletcher around Lenny Brown. Fletcher moving in again, and he gets fouled.
Fletcher starting to show what made him an All-Southwest Ohio Player of the Year at Middletown. Starting to be very aggressive on the offensive end.
He did have 8 points against Wright State, so he's showing the progress. Free throw shooting, only a 45% shooter as the Musketeers get up Nate Turner to bring him into the game for the first time. So Skip wants to keep those big guys with foul trouble on the bench. Gives Terrence Payne a breather, and I'll tell you, Terrence is coming in, has come in and give the Musketeers a lift.
They identified Terrence Payne as somebody that's got to step up, another back front court player for the Musketeers, for them to have success like it's expected this year.
Fletcher misses the second, but Sean Myrick grabs it away. Michael Horton. Levitt goes in, and that is always dangerous when Mel Levitt takes the baseline because he could go so high and so quickly. This time he got cut off and fouled. There you see Nate Turner, that man out of Lemon Monroe.
You mentioned Levitt taking the baseline. He's so talented, so athletic, and we've seen him shooting the three, and that is not what the Bearcat coaching staff would like to see out of him. They'd rather have him be aggressive. He's a slasher player that way. He is not a shooter.
Levitt a couple of years ago, an outstanding player at Euclid High School up in the Cleveland area. He's become a better foul shooter. They cut it back to 16 points. The Musketeers had led by 20. Williams to Posey. Posey over to Gary Lumpkin. Under a minute and a half to go, and the Musketeers turn it over.
Sean Myrick showing some good hands. He got up underneath Lumpkin, provided some heat. Slapped the ball away.
Myrick at Mason County High School, all-state player in the state of Kentucky. He's a 6'1 junior. Turner knocks the pass away. Taken from the side by Mel Levitt as he goes along the baseline from the right side, and a nifty little jumper. 47-33. They cut it down to 14. Lumpkin from the side. He swishes it in for the Musketeers.
Well, Gary Lumpkin has come out of his shooting slump.
Fast action here. Brannon from the right side. He can't connect, and it skips over the basket. Musketeers come down. Final 37 seconds. Lenny Brown, top of the key, bounce pass went into Turner, and Fletcher commits the foul on Turner.
Fletcher and Turner, I'd imagine, had some battles in high school up in that southwest area.
Pat Kelsey ready to come back in for the Musketeers.
You can't help but think of these Cincinnati kids, Pat Kelsey from Elder, Nate Turner, Fletcher, Bobby Brannon. You know that this is a big, big game for those guys. I can remember it was for me. Being able to play in this Crosstown Shootout, being from Cincinnati.
And I have to think this kind of a game, this kind of atmosphere, has helped improve the overall quality even of high school basketball in this state.
The game's been elevated because every year somebody's in the top 25. Somebody's nationally ranked, and in some cases both teams are nationally ranked. It's just a high level of basketball, and that people in Cincinnati are very lucky to have these teams in their own city, not to mention the Kentuckys and the Indianas and the teams that are around them.
Baker back in for UC. Myrick takes a seat in this final 30.8 seconds of the first half. Lead is again 17. Here's Levitt operating against Turner. Now they back off a little bit as we fall under 20 seconds to go. This is Horton. Horton goes in off the glass. Made that one before, but nice follow-up there for the Bearcats. The pass, the shot at the buzzer. We still have 3 seconds to go. The long one coming the other way, And it is short of the mark.
Lumpkin thought there was 0.5 seconds, I think, not five.
.50-35, the Xavier Musketeers with a big lead at halftime. Bob Holtzman has the whole halftime report coming up in just a minute.
Figured the pressure would give them some problems.
Pat, they fell behind by 22 points. They got it to 15 by halftime. You're not daunted in the least. You think UC can come back from this?
Well, I know how that UC feels on the court because I'm being double-teamed up here. Xavier's pressure has been unbelievable. It's taken UC out of what they want to do, and also UC has got to take care of their backboard a little better. It looks a lot worse than a score indicates, so there's 20 minutes of basketball left, and it's 20 minutes in a war.
The Bearcats held their own early. They came out with a very steady fashion. In fact, they were providing the pressure. We're going to see Bobby Brannon head for the wall here, pull up and spot the jumper. Bobby playing his steady game, Pat.
Bobby's playing tough out there. They're double-teaming Bobby every time he gets the basketball. Xavier's saying, listen, we're not going to let Bobby score. We're going to make somebody else score.
But Xavier is getting the rebounds, Ralph.
Yes, they're getting the rebounds, and that's where the key was in the game. If they could sustain themselves on the rebounds. But now, once they get the rebounds, they're getting it out real quick as well.
Lenny Brown, of course, you always have to worry about the Xavier's backcourt. Not only Lenny Brown, but Gary Lumpkin here, who spots up for the three. He really spurred that spurt at the seven-minute mark to push them to that 22-point lead.
Yeah, he did. And Coach Huggins got real upset because someone like Lumpkin, you come into the game, you got a week to prepare, and they tell you, don't give Gary wide-open threes. And they've given him like three or four wide-open threes.
Now, how does James Posey get open for this alley-oop, Pat?
Well, the ball goes from strong side to weak side. You got to put a body on Posey. He's so athletic. He's Xavier's best player. You got to know where he's at all times in the game.
You were talking about the unsung heroes of this first half. We have to think about Terrence Payne and Ryan Fletcher. 9 points for Fletch.
That's right. Fletch has done a great job of getting in there, banging, making simple plays for UC. He hasn't really done anything to hurt them except for the mixed dunk. But other than that, Fletch has finished passes, as you can see on the layup here.
And we saw Sean Myrick in the game. We didn't know whether he was going to be able to play, Pat, but he's in there.
Well, they're going to need him tonight to break some of that pressure. Horton's going to get tired trying to break the press all night. They're going to need him in spurts. Hopefully, he'll be ready to play in the second half.
15-point spread at this point. I don't think we expect that to stand up by game's end.
No, I don't. I think they'll make a run. UC will make a run. How much of a run they make depends on whether Xavier wins this basketball game.
Ralph Lee, Pat Cummings, thanks much. Gary and John are back with more after this. Stay with us.
Tuned it up a notch and went on that 20-0 run. They're going to have to get Brandon back into the game, and Juwan Baker's going to have some kind of role in the second half.
Well, there you saw the back court discrepancy. If you're Skip Prosser, you say just keep it up?
Absolutely. One of the things Skip preaches to his team is coming out of that second half. The first 5 minutes is important. Dave Lappin hurt him in the huddle. They made a spurt. They made a run, a 20-0 run. He's not satisfied with that. He wants to have a run now in the second half and put the nail in the coffin.
15-point lead right now for Xavier. Can UC close it? We'll find out in just a moment.
Well, this year, UC's basketball team has gotten some help from the football team. Guard Brent Petras, who is a former quarterback and wide receiver, Brad Jackson, most valuable player, co-most valuable player, all-conference player, honorable mention, or third-team All-American as a linebacker playing forward for this Bearcat football team. Bob Goin, when he was at Florida State, he had quarterback Charlie Ward that played both football and basketball. He's allowing these two to do the same thing. Listen to this schedule around December. Now, of course, the football team is in Humanitarian Bowl, and they leave on December 25th, the football team does, to start preparing for the bowl game. On the 29th, they come back to Cleveland to play at Gund Arena in the Rock and Roll Shootout. These two guys will take a Learjet on the 27th to fly back to that basketball game at Gund Arena, and then the next morning they'll take a charter back to Boise for the football game on the 29th. You talk about living a dream, and you talk about frequent flyer miles, Petras and Jackson. It's unbelievable. And here, and Petras, he gave them 9 good, solid minutes. He had 6 points. 2 of them were on putbacks, stickbacks after missed free throws. Petras is doing a job, giving Bob Huggins a little bit of depth for this basketball team that's had some problems, of course, with guys that have been suspended.
Thank you.
Here comes Michael Horton handling the ball. Early moments of the second half, 50-35. Xavier with the lead. And there you see in the middle, Kenyon Martin and Bobby Brannon. Brannon has played hard. Martin has been pretty much on and off the floor in the first half of play. Also, they need DeJuan Baker to produce. Interesting stat pointed out by our statistician, Mike McCall, that DeJuan Baker against Wright State was 0-for-11 in the first half of play as far as shooting from the field. He ended up with 26 second half points. So DeJuan Baker's only had 3 points here in the first half. Maybe he's ready to explode again.
5 second call.
Larry Lembo makes the 5 second call. The ball comes back to the Musketeers.
John, you mentioned DeJuan Baker. He had the difference there in tonight's game is the fact that he got 11 opportunities to shoot the basketball. Tonight he's 0-for-2 from the field. Musketeers just have done a fantastic job of perimeter defense.
19 minutes to go in this 65th Skyline Chili Crosstown Shootout. TJ Johnson holding 3 personal fouls back in this game to Ray Braggs, who has 2. Williams tries to go into the paint, back outside to Lenny Brown. To Williams. Williams from the 3-point arc, too hard off the back of the rim, and the rebound comes down to the UC Bearcats' Melvin Lovett. Horton to Lovett. Lovett picked up there by Darnell Williams. Sean Myrick, who has started this second half of play.
Interesting that Baker didn't even come out to start the second half.
Kenyon Martin to Lovett. Lovett around Williams, falls down, and a foul is called on Darnell Williams. There you see Lovett operating. To be honest with you, I think more than anything else, he probably slipped or stood on somebody else's foot and went down, but he got the foul call. And the Bearcats ready to put the ball in. Musketeer fans remain on their feet, which is their tradition to do until their team scores the first points of the half. Either of the halves. Horton ready to put in underneath the Bearcats basket. Horton outside to Myrick. Picked up there by Lumpkin. Over to Brannon. It's knocked away by TJ Johnson, and Torrey Braggs grabs it, and Kenyon Martin then commits the foul. Martin was hoping he was going to get a jump ball out of it, but it goes to the Musketeers.
3 fouls on Kenyon Martin. Good alertness by Torrey Braggs. TJ Johnson with the flick.
Ryan Fletcher gets right back up, but he's in front of the scorer's table ready to check in for Kenyon Martin.
Bearcats trying to make something happen. They open the second half in full court, man-to-man. Discarded the zone that they played so much in the first half. See a little trapping going on. Brannon stepped out, try to trap Gary Lumpkin.
We've seen a couple of the UC games in person, and I'll tell you what, there won't be any quit in this team at all. They've improved a great deal since that Detroit game, which wasn't very pretty, but you could see the effort was there from the opening bell of the season.
The coaching staff told me they did not want to fall behind for obvious reasons, but also because they are not a good come-from-behind team. They don't press real well.
5 seconds on the shot clock. Lumpkin operating out back. Lenny Brown tries the baseline, and a whistle as he tried to take the baseline, and a foul is called.
I think with all the adversity, I think you're going to see Bob Huggins have a year where he's really going to have to coach, which is going to benefit the Bearcats because he's a great coach. He's going to be able to find different ways through adversity to make adjustments and win some basketball games.
Michael Horton commits his second personal foul. Lenny Brown goes into TJ. He's had a battle going in there with Bobby Brannon, and then he lost his balance. The ball went over his head.
So far a little sloppy here in the first 2.5 minutes of the second half.
Nobody has scored in those first 2.5 minutes. It remains at 50-35. The handoff to Myrick. Myrick goes in, goes up, and puts it in. Sean Myrick ignored Lenny Brown flying through the air and was able to dip that one in. From the side, Darnell Williams is a misser, and Myrick comes away with the rebound. Lovett from the side. He hits a three. Bearcats trying to crawl back into this one. It's 50 to 40. Pat Cummings mentioned at halftime this wasn't an insurmountable lead, and
not at all. This game's going to be a war.
Brown, top of the key. He can't hit it. Rebound is fought for underneath, and the Bearcats come away with it. Well, let's see what we call. There's a lot of scratching and clawing and kicking in there. Everybody trying to get their hands on the ball. Looks like Monday night football. Kenyon Myrick is in there. Darnell Williams as they unload. Make that Sean Myrick instead of Kenyon Martin.
And there you see the shot from Lenny Brown. I'll tell you, the Darnell Williams launched one from way down, three-point range. And I don't think those are the kind of shots Skip Prosser is looking for. You can see TJ Johnson got a little aggressive trying to go after the ball, and just a little bit of a tangle up.
UC's ball, and Sean Myrick ready to put it in. A small lineup now for the Bearcats with Myrick, Lovett, and Horton all in there, along with Brandon and Ryan Fletcher. Ball stolen away by Lumpkin, and as he tried to get away, Myrick grabbed him, and a foul is called at midcourt.
You mentioned a smaller lineup. I think the Bearcats are going to want to try to be a little quicker and beat the pressure, try to play man-to-man. And so far, that concept has worked. They've pulled within 10.
Myrick sits down, although he gave the Bearcats a boost here in the second half. DeJuan Baker makes his first appearance of the second half. Lumpkin to Johnson of the Browns. 10-point lead now for the Musketeers. They led by 15 at the half. Braggs, the pass inside. It gets away from TJ, and now a foul is called on Brannon. I think he went down pretty hard.
He lost his balance and fell on TJ's leg. That's the third foul for Bobby Brannon. Well, I'll tell you right now, he gets after it. You're not going to find anybody that works harder inside.
So a couple of UC big men in trouble, as Kenyon Martin has three. He's on the bench. Brannon's on the floor. He has three. Fourth team foul as the Musketeers get ready to put it in under the basket.
Musketeers' execution so far in the half court in the second half has not been good.
Brown takes it in after Horton unsuccessfully went for the steal and opened up the lane. Lenny Brown delivers the first 2 points of this second half, and now he gets a steal, but a travel is called right in front of the Musketeers' bench.
Skip kind of kept his feelings about that call under control. He had a technical in the first half.
We have a timeout. 52-40. The Musketeers in the lead. Let's take a break. Back to the 65th Skyline Chili Crosstown Shootout. There you see the Xavier lead at 12. Don't forget to tune in next Saturday when ABC 9 will bring you another big-time college game when Xavier travels to Indianapolis and Market Square Arena, taking on the Purdue Boilermakers, another top 10 team. That's next Saturday at 7 o'clock. Xavier and Purdue against Gene Cady, another ABC 9 sports production. Musketeers come out with Myrick and Brannon. Michael Horton now holding on to the ball. Mel Levitt still in. There's Ryan Fletcher is, and the Bearcats having some problems getting it down. They do to Fletcher. Fletcher goes in the pass to Levitt. Levitt goes in left side, lays it in.
That's what I'm talking about, being aggressive, John. Make you pay for the press. Get an easy basket.
Xavier hurries it down. Lumpkin in the middle, misses. Rebound knocked around and gets back out to TJ Johnson. Lenny Brown, the fake inside. Now he passes. Tried to go to Torrey Braggs, and he is slammed.
Now that Levitt may have turned an ankle. He came out of the gathering underneath.
He's holding his right ankle. That is the fourth foul on Bobby Brannon.
He's the guy that really made Lenny put the ball on the floor, and he hustled back to try to help out on defense and got called for the foul.
Well, and you can't underestimate what Bobby Brannon means to this team. He's a warrior out there, the senior out of Moeller. 20 points a game, almost 21, 11 rebounds a game, and just the guy that battles you every second of the way.
And their coaching staff told me on Wednesday night at their practice that he's a guy we cannot get in foul trouble. If you look, they're 4-1. The one game that he didn't get a lot of minutes, he had two fouls early against Arizona State. Didn't play a whole lot the rest of the game, and that was their only loss of the year.
He seemed to pick up his game last year after not getting a lot of minutes and not points. But in the NCAA tournament at Iowa State, all of a sudden, Bobby Brannon flourished, and he continued that over into this season. Second shot misses, 53-42. The Bearcats bring it down. Kenyon Martin now into the lineup. A long one by Myrick is way too long. Fletcher grabs the rebound, and as he brought it out, Lumpkin grabbed him around the wrist.
Juwan Baker's going to go back in the game. I think he's going to go in for Sean Myrick after that shot.
Here comes Baker back in. So it's Baker and Levitt. Martin Fletcher on the floor for the Bearcats. James Posey is now back on the floor in place of Darnell Williams for the Musketeers. Pass into Martin. Martin guarded by Johnson. 11-point lead now for the Musketeers. Horton went up from the side and couldn't get it to go. Here comes Brown. Brown right down the middle, throws it up. A foul is called and a charging foul on Lenny Brown.
That's a typical outcome. If you try to go the length of the floor, somebody's going to be waiting for you. There, see, Lenny thought he saw a crease. No question about it. Fletcher takes a good hit. That's his third.
The foul's starting to pile up, and it affects the backcourt.
We talked about the fouls piling up. Kenyon Martin just drew his fourth foul. And
yeah, Bob Huggins just scratching his head now. Now who do I put in? Yeah, he looks down at Brannon. He has four. Martin has four.
He's talking to Bobby Brannon right now. I'm asking him. He got 14 minutes. Somebody's going to have to play a little bit soft.
Lumpkin from the corner. Big high bounce. You saw Levitt go up. Johnson came down with it. Back to Lumpkin. Lumpkin to Darnell Williams. Darnell streaks inside. He can't hit it. And Kenyon Martin comes away with it. Boy, body's flying all over the place right now. Posey tips it, but Juwan Baker gets it back for UC. Second half so far, not a thing of beauty. Posey comes down after the miss by Levitt. Johnson over to Lumpkin as Xavier sets up.
You mentioned a little, not a thing of beauty, a little sloppy. Musketeers are just 1 of 7 field goal attempts in the second half.
6 minutes gone in the second half of play, and Xavier has only scored 3 points, and the ball is kicked away, and Posey gets called for the push against Michael Horton. Timeout called on the floor, and as they do that, 53-42 advantage now for the Musketeers. We are 5-1 coming into this game. A lot of people have thought they'd be 6-0. However, I'll tell you what, Charlie Cole's team played a great team, played a great game on Tuesday night against the Musketeers, playing great defense, and then they always shoot well from outside.
They got a great squad up there, 6-0. Wally Zerbiak, Frierson, they got some great players. And that is not an easy place to play.
You lose Devin Davis, and you still, and Rob Mestis is hurt and out, and he still has the guys and puts together a great game plan.
It really handled Xavier's pressure.
UC with the ball, trailing by 11. Back outside to Horton. He's open. He'll take the shot, and oh, it rims around twice and out. You don't come much closer than hitting one than he just did. Johnson to Braggs. Braggs a couple of dribbles, hands it back to Lumpkin to Posey, top of the key. 15 seconds on the shot clock as Martin is out there covering Posey. He looks for a man to pass. He finds Braggs. Johnson in the middle to Darnell Williams, left side. Can't get it to fall. And Xavier has really gone cold. And now a foul called on Darnell Williams as he is grabbing for the ball against Mel Levitt.
It's Darnell Williams' third foul. He has just 4 points. Really not in the flow of the game at all tonight. Musketeers again, just 1 of 8 now from the field in the second half.
Lenny Brown back on the floor replacing Darnell Williams. Baker puts it into Martin. Martin tosses ahead to Michael Horton, and Horton has it taken away, but a whistle and a foul on the Musketeers. And I believe Torrey Braggs is the offender.
It's his third. And you're right, John, the fouls are adding up. Definitely going to be a play a factor here as the game rolls on.
Juwan Baker now operating against Posey. Over to Ryan Fletcher. Top of the key picked up by Braggs. Over to Michael Horton. Looks back. Juwan Baker trying to find a space to shoot. And covered well like a blanket all night long. Skips inside. Misses. Fletcher rebound goes up and he's fouled.
Fletcher with a great rebound. Used one arm to hold James Posey down and grab the rebound with the other. Take a look at that. You can see Kenyon Martin. Things are getting very aggressive underneath. The ball goes down there. You see, actually, that was Gary Lumpkin that Fletcher was holding down.
Takes it back to a 10-point lead now. Again, the Musketeers have tallied only 3 points so far here in the second half of play. And again, more than 7 minutes have passed us by after being so hot there in the first half, shooting 58%.
Bearcats staying at man-to-man defense.
Pass inside, and another foul is called, and I believe it's on Kenyon Martin, and that may be the end for him.
That's a tough break for the Bearcats. That's his fifth with 12:33 left in the ball game.
Ray Braggs had given him a little fake to the right and then shot inside toward the basket to receive the pass, and Kenyon was just one step behind.
They're going to need guys like Ryan Fletcher to step up now. I don't think Coach Huggins is going to put in Bobby Brannon. He can't afford to lose him, but Ryan Fletcher is going to have to step up, and he already has. He's got 10 points in the ballgame tonight. That's a career high.
Brent Petras now coming back into the lineup, replacing Kenyon Martin, who fouls out with 12 and a half minutes to go in this ballgame. So we talked about undersize. Now we're talking about really undersize with Levitt and Baker, Brent Petras, Michael Horton, and really the only big guys, Ryan Fletcher.
You can see that T.J. Johnson and Torrey Braggs did a nice job on Kenyon Martin. Finishes the ballgame with just 2 points and 4 rebounds.
Braggs' second one skips along the basket and falls in. So it's back to a 10-point margin now for the Musketeers.
It's not an insurmountable lead. The Bearcats, despite their foul trouble, are capable of putting a run on.
And we still haven't seen Juwan Baker shoot the way Juwan Baker's capable of. If the UC Bearcats manage to spring him in some way and get him open, this could close in a minute. Levitt into Petras. Petras again showing great poise and coming in and scoring for the Bearcats. Maybe he played the wrong sport. Here's Braggs up top. Swings it over to Lumpkin. Back outside to Lenny Brown.
Bearcats are looking for opportunities to trap. We've seen them try to trap out on the floor and get a 5-second call.
Pass inside to T.J. Johnson. Almost went in. Flip back to Braggs, and Braggs lays it in. T.J. with a nice job of just tapping the ball.
The Musketeers are going to look to get the ball inside. Brad Preachers is guarding T.J. Johnson. A mismatch. Look for the Musketeers to try to get it inside.
Almost steal that one away. The Bearcats get it back. And steps taken by Mel Lovett as he tried. He saw the opening to the basket and he traveled. We have a timeout here at the Cincinnati Gardens. 57-46. Xavier in front. Xavier against UC. Xavier with an 11-point lead. Let's listen in to Joe Sunderman and Andy Mack on 55 KRC calling this last sequence.
Johnson looking for the lob. It's not there. Now to Lumpkin. Now the lob into Johnson. It's knocked away and it's battled for. Frags will pick it up and lay it in. A break for the Musketeers. Petrus with a good defensive play. Knocked that pass out of the air. Bragg's able to recover it and lay it in and the Musketeers.
That just moments ago, and we went to a break, 57-46. Xavier in the lead, 11:39 to go. Certainly, UC Bearcats have had an opportunity to make a run. You kind of wonder, have they missed that opportunity?
Well, I got the feeling it was a lucky timeout, I think, for the Bearcats. I'm not sure that was called or a TV timeout, but Musketeers looked like they were on the verge of making a run. They had two steals right in a row, which gives them 23. They've caused 23 turnovers now.
Let's set the players on the floor for you now. Gary Lumpkin handling the ball. T.J. Johnson just ahead of him. James Posey, Torrey Braggs, and Lenny Brown. Brown outside, picked up by Michael Horton. Takes it left side, gets caught, loses the ball, gets his dribble back.
Bearcats staying man-to-man, and the mismatch inside with T.J. Johnson and bad features.
Brown gets the shot. Now Lumpkin open. Fake shot underneath. Goes to T.J. Johnson, who's fouled. And again, there's the mismatch.
Shows you how sharp Gary Lumpkin is. He's really learned to be a quarterback in this team. See him go up for the shot. He understands and sees the mismatch. Let's exploit it. Let's get the ball down into TJ on the blocks. And TJ goes up strong, gets the foul. Good job of TJ Johnson being active. He got the ball, kept it alive.
And we saw him just a moment ago make the tap over, get the basket to Torrey Braggs. Juan Baker leaves again. Sean Myrick back in. They've gone back and forth here in the second half.
Mentioned that TJ does so much more than just what you see in the box score. He hasn't even taken a field goal attempt yet tonight, but working hard and making things difficult. Did a nice job on Kenyon Martin. Coach Crosser calls him one of the most unselfish players he has.
Bearcats get it after that Mel Lovett rebound. Have some difficulty getting over. Now Lovett has to go ahead. It's taken by T.J. Johnson. Johnson ahead to Posey, who runs right over Mel Lovett, I believe.
He's had a tough night tonight. He's run over the official and a couple other people.
Sean Myrick actually was the Bearcat right there. And he got buried by Posey.
Got to give the offensive player room to come down. Look at the athleticism of Melvin Lovett. That ball was in the third row. If it wasn't for his 39-inch vertical leap, and take a look at Posey. You have to give room for the offensive player to come down for the ball.
Posey steps to the line, 6 points and 5 rebounds. So not big as far as the shooting category, but the 5 rebounds have helped out. And he had a couple of those when the Musketeers were making that run. He had a couple of slam stick backs that really allowed the Musketeers to take off. Posey hits the first of two. Darnell Williams coming back into the lineup now for the Musketeers. And T.J. Johnson sits down. He gets a nice hand.
Posey's such a difficult guy to prepare for if you're trying to guard him. They don't run any sets for him. And he comes off the bench, and he's just so spontaneous. And he makes things happen. He's a very, very difficult guy to prepare for and guard. Musketeers 79% from the free throw line. 15-19 tonight.
They get it up to 80%, right there. 60-46, the lead is again 14 as Myrick looks to throw it in. He gets to Fletcher, Fletcher to Horton. Horton trapped by two. Petrus now throws ahead to Lovett, and Lovett backs it up as the Musketeers get down and cover well. The pass into Fletcher. Fletcher had a lay-in, couldn't do it. Here come the Musketeers in the other direction. Posey, long pass into the corner to Brown. Brown, bounce pass into Braggs against Fletcher. He goes up off the glass.
Musketeers trying to take advantage of the mismatches inside.
The lead is again 16, so UC played catch-up, and now the Musketeers have increased their lead, which was 15 at the half.
Bobby Brannon looks to check in.
Myrick has the ball knotted away and stolen by Braggs. Braggs to Brown. Brown operating, coming down. Three on three, lays it in!
This might be the Musketeers' second spurt. They're turning the Jets up a little bit.
Myrick has it swiped from behind. Now the scramble, Braggs. Braggs throws it ahead to Lumpkin. Here comes Lumpkin, two on two. Lumpkin tries to go in the middle, puts it up, can't get it. And a foul is called on Brent Petras.
And let me tell you, John, Torrey Braggs made two outstanding plays to cause the two turnovers and caused both of those possessions. All over the floor, made a great play. Look at this play. Gets it back into Lenny Brown. And Lenny goes the length.
Bobby Brannon has come back in now for the Bearcats and Dwan Baker as well. As Myrick sits down and Ryan Fletcher. Fletcher's getting a lesson in basketball from Bob Huggins. Lumpkin, there it is. 16 points, 3 assists so far.
John, his role's been so much different here in the second half. He had 16 points. He had 14 points in the first half. Been much more of a leader, more of a passer here in the second half.
Bragg sits down. TJ Johnson comes out. Now Pat Kelsey is going to provide a breather as well. Let's go over to Dave Lapham on the sidelines. David.
Hey, Popo. Underneath the basket here, Brent Petras is laying it all out in the court. He's a tired young man. I mean, this tempo is tough right now. He has to post up with TJ inside. I mean, one thing they talked about is no second shot since UC is so undersized, and just try to run because their sea legs are established right now. Boy, they're wobbly out there, guys.
Pat Kelsey comes in. Lumpkin sits down, and as Lumpkin came over to the bench, Skip Prosser pointed his head like, nice thinking out there. 65-46. The lead is 19 now for the Musketeers. The pass out to Levitt. Levitt over to Michael Horton.
Lumpkin went to the bench with his 17 points.
Posey with the steal. Posey behind his back. He loses it. Here come the Bearcats. Levitt to Brannon. Pulls up too short. Rebound, Darnell Williams. Ahead to Lenny Brown. Brown's going to take it in, and just a nice touch.
Musketeers running on all cylinders now. This is their game.
That is tough. He's coming at full speed and has to make a nice little touch on that. And Petras sends it with a three.
You got to give that young man a lot of credit. You mentioned before, football shape is a lot different than basketball shape.
But I'll tell you, mentality could be the same in both, and he's just cool, calm, and collected out there. Kelsey. Operating now for the Musketeers, who lead by 18 points. Petras 5 for 5 in field goal attempts, 11 points so far. Five seconds on the shot clock. Darnell Williams is open, and it rims out. TJ Johnson's there. He goes up, and he's fouled. And I think that's the end for Bobby Brannon. Unless it was Mel Levitt that committed the foul. It is Mel Levitt that committed the foul. That's his third.
But I'll tell you, part of the reason that T.J. Johnson was able to get that basketball was because Bobby Brannon was playing soft. He did not want to get his fifth foul and didn't want to be real aggressive to box him out.
Third foul on Levitt, 10th team foul. Musketeers trying to make it two wins in a row over the UC Bearcats.
TJ Johnson came into this game over 90% from the line. That's a big improvement over last year, and he knocks those two down.
Back to a 20-point advantage now for the UC Bearcats. Juan Baker ahead to Horton to Petras. Petras fires over to Levitt. Levitt will try from the side, and he nails a three.
Still lots of time left in this ballgame. 8 minutes.
Pass under TJ. He goes up. Nobody fouls him that time, and he hits.
You got Bobby Brannon down there with four fouls and Brad Petras. Musketeers are going to try to take advantage of that.
They steal it away. Lumpkin goes up, and he's fouled by Michael Horton.
That's three fouls on Michael Horton.
Let's take a look at a Kroger action replay while we have a moment. And there we see it just gets away from Michael Horton, spinning around as Lumpkin. Lumpkin goes up.
It might have been, that was Juwan Baker, I think, that the ball got out of control from.
Kenyon Martin, only a sophomore. There'll be better days for him. Another just extremely athletic player has come to the Clifton campus, and Bob Huggins is going to do well with this team. We have a break. 73-52, Xavier in front. Xavier on top by 21, 7:46 to go. Let's hear one of the last sequences in from the dulcet tones of Paul Keels and Chuck Machock on 700 WLW.
In front of Baker, brings it top of the key, dribbles behind his back and loses the ball. Levitt with it, Cincinnati. He'll get it to Brandon on the right point. Slows down, shoots a jumper, right wing. Brandon off target. Rebound ripped away by Darnell Williams. Xavier, 65-46, Muskies leading and running. Brown lays it up and into the right side. And Lenny Brown, 21.
There you hear from 700 WLW. Always a great call from Paul Keel. 73-52, 7:46 to go in this second half. And some interesting stats here from Mike McCall, Gary.
John, we've been talking a lot about the pressure defense of the Musketeers. They average 27.8 turnovers coming into the ballgame, forcing their opponents to 27.8. They've turned over the Bearcats 28 times tonight and gotten 27 points off of those turnovers. 16 steals for the Musketeers.
Levitt in the backcourt takes it across. Head to Horton. Horton on the move, misses. Rebound, T.J. Johnson. T.J., long pass down to Pat Kelsey. Kelsey up top, Darnell Williams can't control it, but he does keep it in bounds. Tosses it back out, and Lumpkin picks it up in the backcourt. A little excitement there, and all it did is take about 15 seconds off the shot clock. Williams cuts across and hits.
That's his first bucket in a long time.
Bearcats quickly down court this time to Levitt. Now he retreats to Horton. Horton over to Myrick. Myrick, long three, can't get it. Rebound, fought for in the corner. Petrus went after it, and it's controlled by the Bearcats. Levitt goes inside, goes up as he falls. No foul call. Melvin was looking for it. And the ball out of bounds. It'll be the Musketeers in control. Kelsey comes out. Lenny Brown comes back in now for the Musketeers.
You can see Levitt taking it left-handed. No call. There's got to be some kind of call there.
Which is exactly what he's saying.
Either way.
Brags to Lumpkin. Sean Myrick is there to take it away. Myrick takes it up off the glass. Good job, Sean Myrick. Nice hustle. Pass ahead. Darnell Williams has to chase it. He's able to save it. No, he doesn't. Now Skip says, what are you guys doing? He had pulled Posey off the bench, and he said, I'll sit back down.
There has been a fall in the intensity level over the past minute. A little sloppy on the Musketeer end.
Levitt tries a long one, and he misses everything. The air ball picked up by Williams out to Brown. Brown hurries it down. UC has the numbers, and Brown backs it up. Xavier now content to take some time off that clock, it appears. Lumpkin operating against Petrus to Lenny Brown. Pass inside Johnson all alone as he moves to the basket.
Give credit to the Musketeer guards. They recognize what they're dealing with down below. Six assists for Lenny Brown.
Levitt with a nice quick step to Petrus. Petrus hits it in. Ren Petrus continues to hit everything he puts up there. 21-point lead remains for the Musketeers. Lumpkin is trapped to Brown. Brown ahead to Williams. They get it across. Williams passes to Ray, goes in, and a foul call. There you see Williams with a pass to Braggs, and Braggs came down a little gimpy. He either stepped on someone or was stepped on.
I know a couple of players really coming off that Miami loss did not like the fact that their fans were saying overrated. The chant at the end of the game really stuck with the Musketeers. And I know, as I said, talking to Skip before the game, they had a great week of practice. I think that was a motivating factor.
Let's go over to Dave Lapham. Dave?
Papo, Xavier is talking about the knockout punch right now. They want to rebound the basketball and run. I mean, really get after it. And then they were also saying when you break the press, break it for dunks and layups. So they really want to turn that intensity level up and step on the throat if they can one last time, guys.
Ray Braggs at the line, and he is now 5-for-6 on free throws, already 4-for-4 from the field today. So Torrey Braggs having a very efficient afternoon.
12 points and 5 rebounds.
Levitt going in and out. Now back to Michael Horton as we approach the 5-minute mark of this game, and Xavier up by 23 points. Into Brannon. Brannon covered by 2 outside to Myrick. Myrick to Levitt. He'll let it go, and he hits a 3. Lumpkin trying to dribble through traffic, and one of the guys getting in his way was Brent Petras, who commits the foul.
It's his third on the wide receiver.
It's become very quiet in here in the last 2-3 minutes. In fact, I was noting going over to Dave Lapham, was tossing to him before. He didn't have the tubas playing or the fans. He actually could hear me that time as Lumpkin hits the first foul shot.
Not many of these games have come down to where usually it's last second type, especially in this building. And we've had a couple of those.
UC had a lopsided win at the Shoemaker Center in the early 90s. And I think you go back to the 50s and that and find another one that had a margin of victory that wasn't close, but normally these are nail biters. 81-59, 4:40 left in this one as Myrick losing his dribble, covered by Posey, gets it across to Brannon. Brannon in the corner, guarded by TJ Johnson. Pushing his way inside, now pulls up and hits and misses everything, and it skips off and out of bounds. It'll be the Musketeers' ball.
T.J. Johnson got away with one of the classic fouls, and that is to hit the elbow of a shooter. Throws you way off, and he got away with it. Just a little tap will throw you off.
You see, still with some full court pressure here. Lumpkin over to Posey. Posey picked up there by Myrick to T.J. Johnson.
And, John, you're right. There is no quit in this Bearcat club. They're still working hard.
Lenny Brown outside from the left side. Too hard. Rebound, Brannon. And it's taken away by Lenny Brown. Lenny Brown spins, goes up off the glass. Oh, my. What a move by Lenny Brown.
I think that's going to be Bobby Brannon's fifth foul.
There wasn't much he could do about that one.
Good steal there. You see Lenny Brown, the fake pass and the swirl move, and Bobby Brannon gets called for the foul.
I'd be dizzy after all this.
He's one of the great finishers in college basketball today.
Brannon 1-for-6 from the field, 5 points and 3 rebounds, as Xavier did a real good job of neutralizing him. But look for big things from Bobby Brannon this season.
You know, they really neutralized Bobby Brannon inside and Kenyon Martin in the inside. And we talked about the fact before the game that Brannon and Juwan Baker were the keys for the Bearcats, and the Musketeers neutralized all those guys. They took all of the known factors out of play.
23 points now for Lenny Brown. That's his season high as Ryan Fletcher trots into the game for the Bearcats.
I heard him on the radio all week talking about his last-second heroics last year. And at the end of his quote, talking about how great it was, he said, but I want to forget about that because I got to concentrate on this year. And that he has done.
Short that time, and Levitt picks up with the deflected ball. Gary Lumpkin, 21 points. So the backcourt continues to do well for the Musketeers, and a foul is called as Fletcher took it to the basket.
And John, that's 44 points for the Musketeers starting backcourt compared to guys like Michael Horton and Juwan Baker, who really had tough games, had a tough time today. Really the difference in the game. Those are the two guys, by the way, Lumpkin and Brown, are the catalyst for the Musketeer pressure defense, and the guys that usually benefit from the easy baskets that causes.
Fletcher hits the foul shot, and we have a timeout. 83-62, Xavier way in front. We'll be right back. A Xavier rebound, and then a Xavier fast break.
They always look to push it up. Lenny Brown, like I said before, one of the great finishers in college basketball today.
And of course, TV sportscasters love those kind of highlights because it compacts three or four different things in about 7 seconds or so. 83-62 Xavier, 3:44 left in this game. The Bearcats come out with Myrick and Levitt and Horton, Petrus and Ryan Fletcher. Musketeers come back on the floor with Lumpkin and Brown, TJ Johnson, Torre Braggs and James Posey. Musketeers about to put away their second straight Crosstown Shootout victory. Xavier owned the advantage in the 80s. They won 6 out of 10 games. However, UC had the advantage, still really holds the advantage in the 90s. Pass into Posey, misses once, goes back up. It's knocked away. Here comes Horton. And I'll tell you what we see is why college basketball is so great is the unpredictability. How Xavier could go over and lose and really get handed it to him by Miami, come back and play such a great game here against UC.
It really is a testament to the character of the players and the coaching job that the Musketeers have done, the Musketeer coaching staff, to get them, pick them back up. And like I said before, I think it's one of the losing at Miami. It was probably one of the worst things that Bob Huggins wanted to read in the paper the next day, because he knew that they'd come into the Crosstown Shootout with fire in their eyes.
It also says something about college basketball in our area, because these are two teams that they always play great ball, and you go over, and sometimes Miami gets overlooked. But look what Charlie Coles has put together once again. Fletcher misses the second one, and Petrus put it up, but a foul committed.
The fact that both of these programs have grown like they have in the 90s has been just great for the city. Any true basketball fan, whether it's UC or Xavier, you enjoy it. It's great to see both teams bringing quality, nationally ranked teams into the city to play.
Sean Myrick now has 4 fouls.
Certainly made this rivalry great to watch every year.
And it seems like the coaches are more comfortable in playing this game in late December or mid-December as it is now. I don't think they liked it a great deal when it was in their conference schedule. Last year it came their second game of the season. That was too early. This year they were able to get about a half dozen games under their belt, then play it. Got a feeling if they would really have the ideal time, it might be somewhere between Christmas and New Year's, away from exam week. This was exam week for the University of Cincinnati. Fletcher from the right side can't get it. Brown grabs the rebound. Under 3 minutes to go in this one. We thought this was going to be the final Crosstown Shootout we'd see at the Cincinnati Gardens, but the Convocation Center at Xavier won't be ready for this game in 2 years, so it'll return here in 2 years as Posey puts it up. Pass in Fletcher, and Ryan Fletcher's has a nice outing tonight.
16 points.
Again, the Musketeers taking some time off this clock. 2 minutes now left. 10 seconds on the shot clock. Posey, top of the key. Lumpkin waiting it down to five. Fires way long distance. He misses, but the ball will go with the Bearcats.
John, where do you think the Musketeers will end the week? Started at number seven, get a tough loss up at Miami, but then a very impressive showing against a great, normally nationally ranked basketball team in UC Bearcats.
Yeah, I was thinking they were going to probably fall to 12 or 13, but I'll tell you what, they might not fall so far just because of the way they've come back in this game. And again, it's an impressive win anytime you can beat the University of Cincinnati.
We talked about the importance of this game as a Crosstown Shootout, obviously, but nationally, the coaching staff at UC said this is a big game for us because we got to play the seventh-ranked team in the country for our RPI index. We played Alcorn State, beat them pretty bad at home, and we fell in the power rating. So it's become not just a Cincinnati important game from a Cincinnati perspective, but also from a national perspective in this year, and it's always true for the Musketeers end as well.
Well, and the Musketeers won't be able to celebrate this one very long. They have to get ready for Purdue, and the Musketeer and the Bearcats can't be too troubled about it. They have Minnesota coming in at the middle of the week.
That was another reason this game was so important for the Musketeers to go up to lose to Miami, and then if they had gotten beaten today by the Bearcats and have to go to Purdue in Indianapolis, and had they lost there, they probably would have fallen out of the top 25.
Gene Cady with another outstanding team, which he seems to put together every year. The first time we've ever seen them been able to broadcast a game between the Musketeers and the Boilermakers, so really looking forward to that one. And a nice facility at Market Square Arena. Down to 8 seconds on the shot clock. Lumpkin takes it inside, and he goes down, so does Ryan Fletcher, as we hit the 105 mark of this game.
You saw James Posey hang on the rim a little bit. He was not showing off. He wanted to make sure that the area underneath him cleared so he didn't turn an ankle or hurt anybody underneath, and that's a rule that they put in, which I think is a good one. Skip's going to clear his bench a little bit.
Going to bring in Nate Turner and Terrence Payne, who had some really good moments there in the first half. Mo McAfee, Elvin Brown, and Reggie Butler. And the five that were on the floor come walking out, and they get a standing ovation from the full house here at the Cincinnati Gardens.
Well deserved.
Let's take a look at tonight's Synergy power play of the game. Lumpkin goes to the line, and he hits one.
We talked about those turnovers, John. 29 turnovers the Musketeers caused. That's the second most turnovers in UC history.
Okay, here's the Synergy power play of the game, and here we see the pass inside. As the Musketeers intercept, take it up court. There's Lenny Brown all the way to the hoop.
That's a good choice. I think that's really a play that broke the Bearcats back right during a run in the second half.
Back to live action as Ryan Fletcher going to the line. Spent a lot of time at the line for a guy who didn't start in the game, although he's seen considerable moments. There you see Skip Prosser talking to the guys that played the bulk of the time here tonight for the Musketeers. Has to be very happy with the way this team bounced back. Under a minute. This is McAfee dribbling down the court. Pass ahead to Butler. Butler to Elvin Brown. Brown puts it up and misses, and the rebound to the Bearcats. 35 seconds to go. Fletcher from the right side. He'll put it up. Rebound to the Musketeers. Butler ahead to Elvin Brown. The final 25 seconds now ticking off the clock for another Crosstown Shootout, and the ball is lost out of bounds. This game was tied at 14 apiece at around the 11-minute mark of the first half. Xavier ran off 19-14, then it was 31-22, and then Gary Lumpkin hit a couple of threes as The Musketeers made a big-time run, and they led by 15 at the halftime. UC got it down to 10, but it's going to end here on a 20-point margin and a victory for the second year in a row for the Xavier Musketeers. Bob Huggins, Skip Prosser shaking hands in front of the scorers table.
Those are two pretty good friends.
You bet. They all have a lot of respect for each other's coaching. We've made our selection for tonight's Skyline Chili star of the game. And for the UC Bearcats, how could you overlook Brent Petras? 6 out of 6 from the field, 7 rebounds, 13 points. The football player turned basketball player is the Skyline Chili star of the game. And for the Xavier Musketeers, this one becomes a little bit more difficult. Maybe we're still tabulating those results. Who knows? As you take a look at the scene down on the basketball court, as the Xavier fans have come out, some of the fans have come out here. Not the scene that we saw anyway the other day. There it is. The Skyline Chili star of the game, Lenny Brown, 23 points, 6 assists, 8 from 8 from the free throw line. And I'll tell you what, that had to be a close one over Gary Lumpkin. But Gary, he had a great game, too.
He had 23 points, 6 assists, and 5 rebounds. Provided great leadership as a quarterback the entire game. And that had to be a very difficult choice.
We'll be back to the Cincinnati Garden. 88-68, Xavier wins the 65th Crosstown Shootout. For Gary Massa and for Dave Lapham, this is John Popovich. Good evening from the Cincinnati Gardens.
Tells me you will enjoy it. Coming up, we'll look at how Xavier earned the trophy for the second straight year, and this time in decisive fashion. That and more in sports.
Everybody in the city is either a Musketeer fan or a Bearcat fan. It's a game, you know, that you hate to lose.
Our handy-dandy newsroom dictionary defines a rivalry as persons or things trying to outdo each other. It defines a feud as lasting hostility between people or groups. I define the Crosstown Shootout as some of both. To the Gardens, where even Mr. Musketeer was looking to kick Bearcat butt. The game was closed for about 12 minutes. Lenny Brown to James Posey for the jam. He had 10 points and 5 steals. UC answers. Off the missed free throw, Brent Petras tips it in. He had 13 points and 7 boards. X led by 2. Muskie started pulling away, though. Terrence Payne inside for 2 of his 4, part of a 20-1 run for the Muskies. Gary Lumpkin had 2 threes in that run. He had 23 points in the game, and Coach Huggins was doing a slow burn at the half. Xavier led by 15. The Muskies' biggest lead was 22, but the Cats scratched back. Mel Levitt led the Cats with 19. And Ryan Fletcher came off the pine for a career-high 17. UC pulled as close as 9, but no closer. Lenny Brown had a big night with 23 points and 6 assists. And Xavier forced Cincinnati into 29 turnovers, just 2 off the school record. The end result, Xavier's second most lopsided win in the history of the Shootout, 88-68.
A couple of our players ain't really, you know, experienced this type of atmosphere. You know, we knew what to expect going in. And I think we wanted to get after them early and show them what type of game it was. You know, we thought if we get into them, take a little bit of our confidence away, I thought that would be to our advantage, and that's what we did.
You know, we didn't rise to the challenge starting with me. I didn't. I played bad, and, you know, I got no excuse.
Dwan Baker also struggled for the Bearcats. He finished with...
Well, Xavier is no longer playing second fiddle. In the 65th annual Crosstown Shootout, the UC Bearcats were looking to revenge last year's heartbreaking loss to the Muskies. And after Xavier's disappointing loss to Miami on Tuesday, UC was really thinking upset. Well, as it turns out, after the game, they were very upset. Our Matt Miller has the story.
Xavier was jumping at the chance to go for a second straight win over UC in the Crosstown Shootout. The Muskies came out firing with their hard-pressed defense, forcing 29 turnovers in the game that led to easy hoops. Meanwhile, UC was having trouble just getting anyone to get the ball in the whole period.
We turned it over 29 times, they turned it over 19. We get our rebound at 31-29, that's 12 possessions.
12 possessions, a lot of possessions to give up.
It's like a snowball effect for the most part. You know, nice one person gets a steal, then next thing you know, they might get the ball past half court, but somebody deflects it. You know, and I think it's just, you know, it just continues to add on, you know, to the pressure.
Xavier's starting guard tandem of Lenny Brown and Gary Lumpkin lit up the scoreboard, pouring in 23 points apiece, while the Muskies defense clamped down hard on UC's big guns and left the Cats senior Bobby Brannon with a sour memory of his last shootout.
I'm embarrassed the way I played.
UC made a run in the second half to close the game within 9 points, but then Xavier went back to work, scrambling for the loose ball, hitting the big threes, and then driving the final stake home with an 88-68 victory. And so the 20-point margin of victory goes down as Xavier's largest ever in Crosstown Shootout history, turning the Crosstown Shootout into the Crosstown Blowout and giving the Musketeers their second win in a row over the Bearcats.
We take a win any way we get it, really. I mean, you know, to take two in a row, that means a lot because, Xavier was always second rate to Cincinnati in the city. I think it's changing now.
I mean, they said they can beat us 9 out of 10 times. Well, I guess they got 8 more times to try. I don't think you get too much bigger than that unless it's a national championship.
That's the first time in a decade we've been able to beat Cincinnati twice in a row. And when you do something that's not been done in a while, I think that's a feather in the kid's cap, and I'm very happy for them.
From the Cincinnati Gardens, Matt Miller, News 5.
Next up for the Bearcats will be